I'd like to open the Deerfield Sewer Study Committee meeting on Wednesday, February 15th at 6:15. On our agenda tonight, we're going to approve the minutes from our last meeting. Our old business is the Captain Lathrop Pump Station Review Planning Study, discuss capital improvement plans, next step, discuss the rate study and next steps, prepare questions for Dave Prickett Consulting, LLC, rate study capital improvements, general discussions on the establishments of management areas, review proposal from Dave Prickett Consulting, entitled Engineering Services Proposal, and then new business, I guess we designer from West End Sampson Status, and review the Headworks project. So, did everybody have a chance to review the minutes? I have a motion.
I'll make a motion to move the minutes from January 12th.
Second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Or?
Aye.
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 Great. So, the Captain Lathrop Pump Station. I guess we got the plans back, or the review back, and they said that it wasn't feasible. So kind of left us where we were before. Just to make you aware of, there were four or five steps in their proposal. And reviewing the proposal, they said that they went out and got some field measurements, but they weren't accurate because of, you know, snow and stuff on the manhole covers. And all of the measurements that they put on the plan that they did supply, they got from, I believe, from Kevin. I'm not sure. They just said the town. But they still sent us a bill for $4,000. So I called them and I talked with them about it and asked them for a reduction in the bill because they couldn't do all the things that they asked for. And I didn't hear anything back, so I called them again and they said, yeah, they would get to it. And I didn't hear anything from them again. So I called them a third time. They said they were going to get back to us. So we're just holding the invoice in the office until, you know, they come back with an appropriate amount for that.
Mayor?
Sure.
To kind of chime in where he's at, I've got at least three phone calls and two emails into him requesting the electronic version of which, because that was my general understanding, is what you guys were looking for, electronics of that study.
No.
You weren't?
No.
Just the electronic of the Headworks? No. Okay. Well, either way, I told him I wanted both. And you've had three phone calls. I've had three phone calls. Again, to like you said, they haven't gone any further. You know, they're part of that contract. They're supposed to be going ahead and looking to see what it's going to take to replace all the electronics, the pumps, the whole nine yards, or at least give us a ballpark idea what's going on there. Again, like you said, we have seen nothing. I've asked that question again. I don't want to be dumping Weston and Sampson down the road. The issue I have at this point with Weston and Sampson is since they have released our contact person, the communication is poor at the very least, or at the very best. If we can get somebody else in there that's going to get on like we had with the previous guy, then I think we'd be okay. If not, then my question is how far do we want to go with these people? If this is the type of contact that we're getting with them at this point, what's going to happen when we're doing a $1 million project or a $5 million project or a $30 million project? You know, if they can't square away information, it should not make a difference how much the cost of the project is.
All right.
So, and again, this is just me personally speaking. This is my opinion. Weston and Sampson has been very good to us. Weston and Sampson has bailed us out when we got into trouble at the transfer station with the old landfill, whole nine yards. Like I said, I don't want to boot anybody down the road yet, but my radar is up saying that I'm concerned.
Yeah.
So, and again, like you said, we're getting no feedback, which isn't right.
All right.
But like you said, bill's sitting there and we're not going to pay anything until we get more. The second part is I also looked at those again, and I don't think they went back far enough. I think they needed to go back one more manhole, which is 303, which is just around the corner. So I was like, because they went to basically the corner of North Main and Kelleher. which is 305. If you come right around the corner, heading south into the, just before you get into the grass, there's another one right there, excuse me, right on the edge of the road. My opinion is that is much deeper than the other. So the information that they're getting from point A to point B may not work that well, because this one that they looked at was one of the ones that was higher. Right. Now, was it higher originally because they ran out of money? Was it because they couldn't lay the pipe in the water? Those answers I do not know. So again, there's more information that I sent to them, and I have not received anything back yet. So to come to his defense, I did not get him that information as far as the height of that manhole yesterday.
Yeah, but they sent us a bill for
everything.
The entire project
complete.
Yeah.
It did not include anything. There was nothing in the, well, I haven't seen the contract except for what you sent me.
Yeah, I don't have anything.
But I don't think there was anything in there for them to design anything.
It was. I thought there was. I thought that was part of one of the parts. Okay, then I stand corrected.
Yeah.
No idea.
We didn't sign the contract. We didn't approve the contract.
No.
We haven't seen it. We don't know. I don't think it's part of our charge to sign
contract. The select board did sign the contract, and I don't believe that it had anything to do with the pump station itself. I mean, it was just the feasibility to go there to do a cost estimate of what it would need to lay out a rough diagram of where the pipe would lay and stuff like that.
Yeah. If it was feasible, then they went on to two or three more steps.
But I didn't particularly care for the language that they use, that they couldn't do it because of the ice and snow. I mean, it isn't like they're having to do the whole road. All they could do is chip the ice off of 2 square inches off the edge of that manhole cover, then go down and measure the pipe. So, you know, I didn't understand that. So
there's no ice on top of the manhole covers. If they got the cover off.
That's just what they said.
If they got the cover off,
yep.
It's not covered in ice.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
All right. Well, that's what it said on there, and that's what I questioned. I said, well, how much work was it really to do this? And, you know, he said, well, I'll look into it, get back to you. Never did, so.
Screwdriver and a pick, and you can open the covers.
Yeah, well, that's kind of what I told him, but it didn't go anywhere.
So that's a dead issue? Or what are you waiting for?
Well,
personally, myself, I'd like to see more information on it, for one.
All right.
Well, that's my opinion, is I would like to see more information on it to find out, you know, did they do it right, and exactly, I will obviously get the contract in my hands and look exactly what it's supposed to be, and make sure that they do exactly what they're supposed to do. And if they don't, then we don't pay them. You send us a revised bill, we'll look at it, I'll approve it, and I'll pay it. But the way it stands right now, you're not gonna get paid.
Mm. Yeah.
Period.
Yep.
Maybe it's catch 22, maybe they're not answering the phone because they're waiting to get paid.
No, that's BS. Completely.
Maybe that's a dear thing.
Oh, no.
Well, then you know what? Then I would cut ties if that's the case.
Yeah.
Over $4,000 or whatever it was, I would cut ties.
$4,000, they shouldn't even be.
$39.99.
Yeah,
$4,000. No, the contract was $39.99.
That's why I said $4,000. Call me a liar for a buck.
I'm just telling you, the selectmen wouldn't approve a $4,000 contract. They were asked to approve something less than $4,000. They approved $39.99.
All right.
Do you remember that?
Is this a dig?
Whatever.
Actually, I do know that the bill was $39.99, but I also do know, I was aware that it was going to be $4,000, so either way, it doesn't matter. But to answer your question, they do answer the phone. I just get no
response.
I don't get a response. I mean, the answer phone, I tell them who I am, and, you know, I didn't get to it. We'll get back to you. I fear it's their money. I mean,
who you talk to?
I knew you'd ask me. The guy said he's the boss.
Chris Weston.
Chris Weston.
Okay. Who was the guy who did our work before who left?
Oh God, brain cramp. Tony DeSomanone.
Yeah.
Tony. Wow, Tony, that's horrible. I feel bad. I do.
Did you find out where he went to?
Presently, right now, he is working on his own, and he does some consulting work with Dave Prickett. So he was supposed to be going down to Tennessee someplace. That fell through after something, and so now he's still in the area. But I know he's looking. He's actually looking right now to possibly go out west. I think Wyoming was the last place that he just went out for an interview, so.
Do you remember that gentleman's name that we met in Agawam?
John something other blah, 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 ski.
Well, anyways, we met this nice guy down in, he manages the sewer systems down in the city of Agawam. And boy, he was very knowledgeable about everything, and everything that Kevin described to him, you know, he kind of smiled and said, oh yeah, I know, we used to work on that about 40 years ago. But he's offered to come up and take a look around and, you know, just give us his opinion and stuff. He might have some other engineers, because I know they were talking about always working with other people. Oh, jeez, I can't believe I find his card.
I think the nice part about him coming along is he has no vested interest.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, he's not an engineer saying, you know, the more this project is, the more that goes in my pocket. I'm sorry, that's just the way it is, because that's how
right, he's
paid.
Not selling something.
Right. Yeah, right. And he's not trying to do anything. He's just, I mean, I would imagine we'd probably end up having to pay for his time to be coming up, because I don't think that, unless he comes up on his own personal time, and that is still obviously to be determined. He asked a couple things. He asked for some channel information from Kip, and Kip got that, and I'm sure he sent that down to him. And the other information he was looking for me was on the lift station information, which I put everything together and sent that everything down to him. Yep. And again, I'll be honest with you, I didn't send that down until today. But we only went down as of Thursday.
So this guy works
week.
For GDF Suez.
Yes.
Yes.
And they run Agawam's sewer system.
Yes.
And
I was going to say that he's been with them for, I think it's 30 something
years. Yeah. The obvious question would be, would they be interested in running ours?
You know, well, that's.
To be honest with you, I think I would bring them in and have them take a look at what we've got first, and then that way we can get some information on it before.
Well, also, maybe he is looking for
maybe
new business.
Maybe
he
they
is
are
looking for new yeah. clients.
Is this something that we could do sooner than later?
Yeah,
as far as making arrangements with him to.
He did say that. I asked him if he could come to this meeting, and he said that he couldn't, but he would come up shortly after, and he was going to actually bring somebody with him,
mm-hmm.
And they were going to go to the plants and stuff. But he was supposed to contact me and. Let me know when he was going to come up, and you know, I would get a hold of Keith and make the arrangements. But you know, yeah. he was talking to us about the lift station that we have at Captain Lathrop, and you know, he was very familiar with the pumps and the setup, and he described kind of how they deal with it. They just have a grinder. I don't know how many of you guys I showed that thing before. There's a company, I'm not sure what their name is, but they make two different things. One's called a muffin monster, one's an auger monster. But mm-hmm. they're basically like these grinders that are in the line. So anything that comes down the line just gets ground up in smaller pieces. And he said
before it goes into the pump station.
Yeah.
Correct. Right, yeah. That makes a lot of sense.
John Decker? His name?
Yes.
Bob Decker's son.
Yes.
He's one of the managers at the sewer... the DPW,
Deputy Superintendent.
And he gave us some information about these precast concrete stations that are made for these muffin monsters, these grinders to fit right in there. And then there's a place for the pump to sit after it and stuff like that. He says it works good for them. Mm-hmm. They still have some buildup, but the vast majority of it, it deals with it pretty well. And they're not real expensive. Well, when I say not real expensive, they're around,
in comparison.
Yeah, in comparison. Yeah. They're about $30,000.
But you also take in consideration how many pumps I'm going through over there.
Yeah.
I just went through a second pump.
Yep.
And each one is anywhere between 65 and 7 grand by the time you get through bringing the electrician in to go ahead and wire it. I mean, granted, we take it out. Mm-hmm. You know, we change out we change everything apart. We put it back in the hole. And then he runs the wires and he hooks it. We can't do the electrical end of that. It's just not what we do. We could, but I'm not going to be responsible for that.
I also, you know, he had heard of this auger monster that, you know, does the grinding, that it would fit right in the channel, like I was saying before, and it takes, he said it works really good. He's seen them, and so I was encouraged, but I told him that Keith didn't particularly care for it, but he said, you know, for the amount of flow that we had, it seems to be a pretty good option, because it's a fairly easy thing to install. You know, the maintenance on them, you know, barring a brick or something like that going through it, it...
Where would you install that?
It would go right into the channel, right at the sewer treatment plant.
At the plant.
At the plant, yep. And the way that it works, John, is that there's like a big screen that fits in. Well, this channel is only 15 inches wide, but it's 3 feet deep. And usually the flow is only about 20 inches deep, but it can fluctuate. That's what Keith told me. And this thing fits right in. It has a grinder, and then it has like a big screen, and it has this, I don't know, it's about a 16-inch round stainless steel drum, and it has holes in it. And inside there's like a nylon auger that turns slowly. So anything gets torn up and stuff gets dragged up by this auger. And as it goes up through there, there's pressurized water to wash all the effluent off of any of the other material. So it's called, is it?
Mechanical bar screen.
Mechanical bar screen. And then, anyways, it drags up to an opening, then it can fall right into a dumpster. And all that material then can be taken to a landfill. So it's not developed into sludge or sediment or what's that other term they use for the sand.
Which is extremely funny, because when you really think about it, that's how this whole thing started.
Yeah.
Because originally, when it came up, I was like, okay, here's money. You've already put $50,000 away this year. You put $40,000 away this year. Ballpark, they were saying it was going to be around $90,000 for the unit. I was like, great. Where are you going to put it? We're going to put it right there. So how are you going to keep it from being frozen? Oh, and now you see where we are.
Yeah.
Is basically how it all started.
Yeah.
So it all boils down to the mechanical bar screen is where the original thought was pushed through, and then we have expanded from there to the headworks, to force mains, to old Deerfield, and that's why basically the committee is together, is trying to figure out which direction we want to go in.
But the bar screen is a different animal than this auger monster. The bar
that
screen
is, correct.
Is a vertical screen, correct. Where it has a bar, an actual bar that goes up, and it has different paddles or some sort of thing,
exactly.
That wipes the material off. But I do believe with the bar screen, what's left is not the same. It can't be treated the same because it's not washed. I don't know how clean this other stuff is, but they claim that it can drop right into a dumpster.
That's correct. Yeah, it becomes solid waste.
Yeah, a front-loading machine can come pick it up and
exactly.
You know, so, but yeah. Anyway,
so this is in place of a headworks.
It's actually it's part of your headworks. It's just a scaled down version of.
It's a very much scaled down version, but. You know, I talked, it's been a long time, but back last June, I contacted the company and spoke with their regional rep, and he said they work fantastic, up to around 1 million gallons a day, and that's about the size of our plant. So I asked to talk with other people, and I talked with it's part of a corrections facility in Plymouth, Mass., but it also serves part of the town, and they have two of those things, and the guy just absolutely loved them, you know. And,
yeah, but they got no flushable wipes there. which is my problem.
Yeah, yeah.
You get rid of the flushable wipes, you get rid of all the plastics that get tossed down there, my problems are gone, you know, and realistically, because it all boils down to if you can grind the stuff up and if you can get the floatables out of it, the plastics and everything else in the dental floss, it's going to make the rest of the system still needs work.
Yeah.
But I think this is—it's going to get you out of the woods. Now the question is how much money do you want to spend on a temporary fix? Because eventually you're going to end up having to do something with the rest of the system, right. At some point in time. I mean, because you know as well as I do—you've all taken the tour, you've seen what the place is. Mm-hmm. It needs work.
But
I think like what Kip and I were just talking about between the muffin monster, and the mechanical bar screen, yeah. You know, do we need to go further in the future? Yeah, I'm sure we probably do, but.
So it won't take the place of the headworks then?
Not really. No, because you're still not separating out your sands and all the others that is all part of a true headworks program. So it takes care of part of your problem. My limited knowledge, understanding, is taking out the plastics and all the non-flushables that are being flushed. That is dramatic. The rest is infrastructure. But as far as treatment's concerned, we got to get that stuff out of the system.
But if we're going to do a headworks anyway, then why spend the money on this?
Well, that's one way to look at it, but another way is that if we did spend the money on this and put it in South Deerfield, then as things progress, then we could always transfer that down to Old Deerfield, maybe.
If we do.
So long as the channels are the same size.
Yeah, well, there, if I remember right, this thing was pretty adjustable. I mean, there is a smaller size, and I don't know if it was 14 or what inches, but and it fits down in there, and there's just a metal, there's metal bars, angle irons that kind of go sideways.
Mm-hmm.
And all you do is, it's only held on in four places on top, bolts. So
four bolts.
Yeah, and when you need to service this thing the way it's set, there's two big bolts on each side. You undo the bolts, and you just pick it right out, and, you know, you put another one down in there. They have an exchange program.
So they originally came out with, I think the number you originally came out with was like 12,000 or whatever. Anybody that I've talked with says plan on 18 to 20. But it's the cost of doing business.
Right. But everybody that I spoke to said, you know, short of a brick going down there, they'll last a couple of years. You know, it isn't.
So. But again, you still have to have something that's going to keep it from freezing.
Right. It needs to be inside of a building.
It's got to be inside something.
But, you know, I think you could put a fairly inexpensive building up because it doesn't need to be much bigger than a two-car garage. And it's not that it takes up that much room. It's just tall. But you'd have to be able to get the truck in there to pick the dumpster up or whatever. But
just be aware that anything that goes inside of there would have, if electrically wise, would have to be explosion proof. Which is going to get extremely expensive.
But there
doesn't. It's just an information for you. That's
right. I don't think that there's that much because
no. But I'm assuming you're going to have lights in there. I'm sure you're not going to go in there with headlamps.
Oh, no.
So you're still going to be looking at outlets and receptacles and
sure.
And the whole nine yards. And, you know, obviously you're going to have the power that's going to this muffin monster thing. I'm assuming it's probably three phase, which would be a savings on money in the long run, which is one of the things that John was talking about.
Right.
We should probably go ahead and take Captain Lathrop, but we continue doing there, go from a single phase to three phase, and we can drop our electric bill by a third.
Yeah.
So. And I'm assuming with the plastic place right there, there's got to be three phase on the street.
Oh, I'd be on that, sure.
Which is literally is only across the street.
Bruce, wouldn't you want to look at maybe putting something before Captain Lathrop pump station?
Well,
if we're going to have this problem on Captain Lathrop, as we continue to have it, putting this at the Deerfield treatment plant is not going to help that pump station.
No,
you almost have to have.
They're kind of, the grinder part is the same animal, but it's all the tube and the dewater.
I understand, but you could you put something in front of the pump station?
A grinder.
The grinder, yes.
Without the mechanical bar screen.
That's correct.
Right, what the literature that I have at home, and I know it does me a lot of good at home, that I got from John, it showed this precast concrete that had, it was formed in there where this grinder fit right into it, and then it was just wired, and then it just dumped into a, you know, like it is now, what do you want to call it, not a holding tank, but, you know, and then there's floats in there when it gets up so high, but everything is really cut up a lot. So the pieces are still there, but because they're shorter and stuff, they don't tend to get tangled up. It pushes it right through. And he did say something about the type of pump. He said, using a different type of impeller.
Well, the Myers pump that we have right now, it's a three-horse Myers pump, single phase, 500 and some odd gallon per minute pump. And it is what they consider, obviously it's explosion proof, but they consider that a non-clog pump. Now, allegedly, because of how the impellers are on the bottom, it's supposed to work somewhat as, like you said, a grinder. But what the problem is it's too much there because the grinding, and then it goes, tries to go right up the tube.
Right.
And or the issue I had in the past is we have foot valves on these so that we can bleed them out to try and get them to be restarted when we have to replace them because you gotta bleed the air out of them. There's a cable that goes down there. There's a chain that goes down there. And then every now and then, you get some rag material that gets built up on that, and when it does, it goes ahead and takes it, and it sucks the whole thing right up inside the pump. So we've gone ahead, we've taken the cables, we've made the cables physically shorter. It is physically impossible for them to get through right now. But eventually, at one point the other day, we had some that got pulled, and I got like a little hook on the wall, and it started pulling the hook out of the wall because it was trying to suck all that rag material back inside the pump again. So it's the people on the street. I'm sorry, I don't want to pick on anybody, but the bottom line is that's the only place it comes from. You know, the rest of the town that goes into South Deerfield and or Old Deerfield could be anybody.
Right.
But obviously there, you know who it is. It's
right there.
I think we discussed in the last meeting, somebody's going to put a flyer out to that specifically that...
Yeah, it's...
Did that happen?
Partly. The flyer's developed, the letter's developed, the language is being adjusted. I was accused of being too...
too much?
Yeah.
Okay.
So...
A little too straightforward.
It's like, well, yeah,
no,
it's like...
No, you didn't draw any pictures.
No pictures, but yeah, our
actually, you know what, to be honest with you...
Said she needs to tone it down, so...
I took some pictures of pouring grease out of a pan into a glass jar. If we can add that in as almost like an informational flyer, and actually, you know, it's, I could have swore that some of the information that's been put out in the sewer bills people would look at, and some people say, well, you know, well, I don't share my sewer bill with the kids, but you have this information, but it's not being done. So at one point, Jane Dragier was coming up with an idea of trying to do something to go through the elementary school and try and teach those kids as to what you can and can't do, make it some type of an artsy thing that works well for her because that's what she does. But the long and the short is if you can educate the kids are going to educate the parents. Mm-hmm. Correct me if I'm wrong.
You're right.
But, I mean, I think in some form or fashion, I think we should try and put together again another type of informational that goes out to the people that are part of the system. Say, listen, please beg with them if we have to. Mm-hmm. Please stop pouring grease down. If you got grease, put it in this jar, put it in your freezer. As soon as it's full, you throw it in the trash. It's a solid waste. The only thing that's supposed to be going in the toilet is pee, poop, puke, and toilet paper. That's it. Everything else is a solid waste. It goes in the trash. And we need to be able to educate the people. If we can educate them, we can save ourselves down the road. But the bottom line is these people have to, first half, they have to know. Because I'll be honest with you, I never knew anybody who put dental floss in the toilet
before.
Yeah,
what do they do? They sit there doing their thing?
They probably do it and then just put it down there and just flush it and, you know, the end of the night thing before they go to bed. You know, I had no idea. When Keith is showing me, literally, he's got miles of the stuff that comes off of the impellers. It's
like
insane.
Fishing line, huh?
Absolutely insane. But I think an education program of some kind needs to go out, whether it's the kids, whether it's the parents, whether you go and pound on everybody's door and show them a bag of what's bad. I don't know where to go, but we need to do something.
Town meeting? Mm-hmm. Have a little presentation.
That's not a bad idea.
Transfer station, right when you dump in your stuff, have a big sign, pictures of what you can go in.
Oh, like better yet, maybe because all the rag material comes from the transfer from there and it goes to there.
Yeah.
We'll just open up the bags and fill the back of the pickup truck and say, look, this is what we're picking out.
Yeah.
Every 10 days.
But we still need to concentrate on Captain Lathrop.
Captain Lathrop is definitely an issue. I mean, because like I said, I mean, we're starting to burn through pumps. You know, previous to my coming here, I don't think they replaced that many pumps, but I don't think the flushables were as prevalent as they are now. Yeah. And or the people that are utilizing or using more of them is probably the easiest way of saying it.
Well,
I don't know.
I think at Captain Lathrop, it's an issue that, you know, it's got to be addressed. So, not to take
it away. But it's town-wide.
Not to take it away from this committee, but I think that, you know, here in the near future, we'll get the information together, and I think we're just going to do something there. We're also going to try to educate the people there, too, but, you know, we'll see what's the least expensive way that we can make that happen over there and see if there's some electrical changes or maybe a different type of pump. I know that he spoke of a different type of pump that wasn't so sharp, because he talked about getting hooked on the rags and it builds up instead of just going, I don't know. Dealing with it, you know, maybe when John comes out, he'll, you know, give us some better information that we can act on right away.
I will pre-warn you, as far as the electronics that are there at that station, the box needs to be replaced, and the relays that are in that presently right now without being upgraded or changed, however they do that. The last time I had an issue, I asked for some spare relays and two floats. So that way, if I had an issue, we could take care of something immediately. He brought me two used ones, saying they can't get their hands on them anymore.
How long can that pump not run in there? If it was the middle of the day, I don't know.
Middle of the day, probably quite a few hours. But keep in the back of your mind, when you're going up Tap and Lathrop, that first house on the right-hand side, he is the lowest, and he is down in the hole. So it will not take much to be able to flood his place. I will tell you, we had an issue on Sugarloaf Street, and it was a backup. It's the town's fault, or it's our responsibility, and we're going to end up eating the cost of the cleanup in their basement. Now, I know there was a $500 deposit that was put down by the homeowner, which the town is going to end up having to reimburse them for. And then I'm still waiting on the last of it to find out exactly what the bottom line is going to be. So
I have no clue as to what the electrical work is, but I don't know if it's something that can be done in a few hours and to change that stuff out.
That I couldn't tell you. I mean, I'm okay. The guy when he was in there, he was chasing a lot of the information, because basically that station right there has floats, which is an old system, and then a pressure, which is supposedly the new system. So we were under the general understanding, because there's like five floats in there. Mm-hmm. So we assumed, poor choice of words, two of these floats and the pressure were together, and these other three floats were together, because there's a switch there that turns them back and forth. So again, you kind of assume that there's a switch that it's turning them on and off. When we were having the issues with both pumps kicking on at the same time, we went as far as we possibly could. We looked at it. Chuck looked at it. We're racking our brains. We finally brought in Elm. The guy, he opens up the thing, and historically, well, you know, like when you're working on cars and stuff like that, you got different colors for different wire. And no, they're all the same color. They're all red. And so you have to break the piece apart, and you have to actually physically follow each one. The guy was like there for like 2 hours, and we came to find out everything's still tied together. So if we kill power to one thing, the entire system's dead. So the long and the short is the only thing that this switch is doing is giving me my electronic information to my computer to tell it when to turn on and turn off. Again, it needs work, and the electronics are weak at best. So, like I said, just a heads up, it's going to be up and coming.
Yep.
Weston Sampson, when they went through and answered our questions on what projects they would prioritize, that was number two. And it should be combined with the Mass Works application for the headworks in the next round. And if you do it by yourself, it would be total budget, engineering, capital, about $1 million to replace Captain Lathrop.
When was that?
That sounds very expensive.
That was 10? When they were here.
Oh, this last time?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I don't know. It sure seems awful expensive. I don't have a price on that precast station, but...
Well, the issue was that they wanted a deeper wet well.
You said that's pretty deep now, though, isn't it?
It's about 20 feet, roughly. That's not my inlet.
The pump isn't.
Pump's about 20 feet, maybe 18. I'm sorry, I really should have measured that before I came.
Well, you say that's about 5 feet square, 6 feet square?
Yeah, it's about 6 feet square, roughly.
So that holds quite a bit. I mean, if it's that deep.
Oh, it does.
That sewer pipe can't be, what, maybe 4 feet down in the ground, if that?
Oh, no, it's not quite a ways. It's within...
The inlet?
It's probably within... The inlet is probably within 3 feet of the bottom.
Why is it so deep?
Because you have to have the flow.
You have to get it underneath the brook.
Oh. No, that's pressure from there out.
Oh. But the whole section is low.
Correct.
They put the pump station was on a high point compared to, you mean...
Right, but it has to be that low to be able to take the flow from all the houses on the street.
Yes, for gravity flow from one end to the other, it has to be that low. But it's 20 feet deep because of where it sits.
Correct. Because of, it has to accept the flow of the houses.
Houses.
That are on the street presently.
Right. So you can make it 10 by 10.
Yeah, you could.
If you had the land.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure how much, what the deal is there as far as who owns what, how much land there is, how much we have for a right-of-way. Because it is in this guy's front yard, so...
You look at the similar situation, like at either of the plants, and if you can't shut it down, I mean, that's a tricky thing to... I mean, if you could shut it down, it'd be easy. You could just dig the thing out, pick it out, put another one in there, and at the end of the day, but how do you shut off all their toilets for a day?
Well, something like that right there.
Bypass.
Yeah, you'd have to bypass it.
Bypass it.
Yep.
But because of the pump station, you know, it...
You'd have to... Basically, you'd end up putting a plug in the end of... Go down in the first manhole just before it goes in there. Put a plug in there. Don't allow it to go there.
Yep.
Allow that manhole to become your sump. Now you start moving from there to your main.
Or you just pump over.
Bypass it, right?
Okay, so you could put a...
You could do it. Yeah. I mean, it's not...
You could put a pump above ground.
Correct.
And just pump it.
Right.
Okay, yeah. All right. Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. Any other, no other discussion on that? Why don't we move over to a capital improvement plan then? See where that gets us.
Anyone really
have any ideas about where we left off last or...
Pay money out of my own pocket and bring it up to Staples and say, make me a copy. Maybe money well spent.
We talked about pump failures, maintenance repair, the pump station, We talked about the pump station as capital improvement. Then we talked about the headworks and whether we want to fund it. Now, we talked about macerators, and we talked about the headworks budget.
And last year when we applied for that grant, we never found out till October, so I'd hate to put things off that far.
In that $40,000 grant that I went for?
Yep.
I didn't get that either. Everything was that side of 495.
Yep.
Nobody this side of 495 got any of that money.
Weren't we going to ask Weston and Sampson for a revised plan for the headworks?
No.
That was...
We don't have a contract to do that.
Because remember, each time they revise stuff and look at stuff, they're going to want money.
But we had a discussion that we originally had. We had an estimate of $1 million for the headworks.
1.4 million.
1.2 million or 1.4 million.
And I think they said that they drew up those plans, and we have a set of plans here somewhere.
We do.
Yep.
And then
I thought that we agreed that we were going to go with that portion without adding all the fluff on for three or four other jobs.
Yeah. The set of plans we have is everything, all the fluff.
Is all the fluff, because you needed something that was to apply for the Mass Works grant, you had to have a shovel-ready project, correct me if I'm wrong, when it was awarded. And if you did not have these set of plans ahead of time, you did not have a shovel-ready. So going on the theory of Mass Works, you ask for the world. Now, you don't get Mass Works, and we end up paying for it ourselves, then obviously it gets pared down dramatically. So, I mean, let me ask you this. If you had the opportunity, somebody comes along and hands you a set of keys to a brand new Cadillac, sure, I'll take that. Or would you say, nah, just give me the Yugo? You know, you take the free keys of the Cadillac.
Yeah.
And that's basically what we did.
It depends on the excise tax.
Yeah. Good point. But the, but the long.
Same thing on the building.
Yeah.
How much is it gonna cost to operate? The building is 5 times bigger than we need.
It is. It's going to cost more money, exactly. So it's originally, like I said, the theory was behind that was to go ahead, because you're still getting all the headworks, true technology headworks, instead of a temporary fix, is basically what it was.
Half the building was that.
I'm sorry?
Half the building was that.
The other half, I mean, because you're still going to end up having to have another wall put between where your electrical room is, because otherwise everything in that room has to be explosion proof. And if, for the cost of the explosion proof, would pay for basically a third anyway of that area. That's why the theory was to go ahead and put that electrical on the outside of that wall to keep it from having to be explosion proof. So then they looked at it, well, if you're going to go ahead and get the opportunity to get a larger area for no money, then why not? I mean, the only thing, because the place isn't heated, that section, so all you're looking at is some lights. So if you had the opportunity for that particular spot, when I'm talking about when they talked about the bigger garage area,
yep.
You only look electrically wise, the only thing you're looking at is lights. No heat, there's no water in there, there's no toilet in there.
It's half a building, half a foundation.
Yeah, it's a half a building, it's a half a foundation.
And we're looking at over $1 million for that.
So, like I said, if you had the opportunity to get it for free, I say go. I say, and that's when I said, we want it for free. We don't have it for free, then you go ahead and pare it down to whatever you want. I mean, you can put a Morton building ring on that thing right now. You know, go ahead, get this Muffin Monster, mechanical bar screen, put a Morton building around it. But you're going to be replacing that Morton building in a short amount of time just because of the gases that are inside that building. The corrosion is going to take its toll on the building. That is the main reason why they're looking towards the brick and stuff like that.
I don't think that it would be that expensive to put up a block building with insulation, you know, foam and stuff. You know, not that size anyway. Right. So.
But to get back to my question, do we have plans that we can build the headworks for $1 million?
No.
I do not believe so.
We have to rehire somebody.
No,
and I've had conversations with a gentleman named John Levin, who designed, you know, these types of plans most all his life. He currently works for Allstate, and you know, maybe John can take apart the plans, you know, and adjust them instead of starting from scratch. I don't know that, but I want to get this John Gladkowski and John Levin, who both said that, you know, they'd look at this and ask them to come to our next meeting and just give us, you know, another point of view of how we can do this for not a lot of money, but get something so we're not just putting a Band-Aid on it.
They'd have to look, obviously.
Right, yeah,
first,
but it, you know, if they've been doing it, I mean, it took me, anyways, a lot of hours looking around there, but these guys do it all the time, so when they look around and they go, yeah, you know, they don't have to study it like I or mm-hmm. any of us did. And they might give us some good insight, but, you know, I feel that, you know, getting rid of a lot of that junk in the sewer before it gets to the treatment plant will sure, you know, make things run better for them. It's not going to make a lot of the other infrastructure last any longer, but, you know, we'll get more life out of our motors and stuff like that, and maybe save some money on hauling that sludge.
So John Levin is a professional engineer, mm-hmm. and he works for who?
He works for Allstate right now.
And who is the other person?
John Gladkowski, GladKowski.
See, I got the last three letters right.
Yeah. And he's a maintenance supervisor.
I got the last three letters right.
Suez.
Yep.
Whatever.
So they're going to try to come and do the plants and then come to our next meeting?
Yes. Yep. I didn't speak with John since I've given him the information, but it wasn't really that much. He just wanted the size of the channels. All right, you want to move on to the talk about the rate study, next steps? I had a meeting today with Eric from Eagle Brook, and he was upset with his sewer bill, and primarily because he said that all of their wells are metered up there, and they provide the town with the meter readings. But this past year, like several other people said, that it was so dry that they used a lot of water for irrigation. He used a figure of 1 million gallons, and I asked him, I said, well, how'd you come up with 1 million gallons if it's all 1 meter? You don't really know. And so what they do is they backtrack and say, well, this is what we used last year, and it was an increase of 1 million gallons. So I don't know. Even their winter use went up, so I don't really know. I know that they're building all the time and adding stuff to it. I told him that we had discussed possibility of putting a flow meter in the main to do that. He really didn't like the way it was set up. And I invited him to come to this meeting and to any meetings because he was concerned that if the schools, private schools, weren't included in the conversation. So I said, no, please come anytime. But I also pointed out to him that, you know, even though $30,000 is a lot of money, it basically provides sewer for I don't know how many buildings, but roughly 250 people. And if you divide that out, it's like 60 cents a day per person. It's not a lot of money.
So he realizes that he cannot get a rebate.
Yes. He tried hard.
No.
But I told him no.
And no, I mean, it says only residential
yeah.
can get
I know.
Rebates.
But he also had not paid the bill, and he seemed to understand at the end of our conversation, but then he wanted to know if we could waive the penalties and the interest. And I said, well, I guess I'm kind of the person to ask, but I said, a few years ago, I didn't pay my property taxes on time. They were in my truck, and I got held up, and I didn't come to the day after, and they charged me $200-something interest. And I tried to argue with the town clerk. I said, look, if I came in at 4 o'clock, you couldn't have cashed my check then anyway, so here it is 9 o'clock the next morning. Is it really worth it? And I ended up paying it. But so I told him he could go argue with the town clerk. Sorry, Barbara.
Does he also realize that that bill is only for the operation and maintenance of the plant now? It's not, it doesn't pay, there's not a dime in it for all of these improvements
for the
and
capital
these
improvement.
Upgrades, the capital improvements.
Yep. And he gets paid, and he's charged $200 for a connection fee? And something,
well,
one residential family?
That's the other thing that I pointed out to him. I says, if you divide this out by roughly, you know, 40,000 gallons, which most of the homes use, you know, and you had to add $100 service fee for every that, you know, it would be substantially higher. But anyways.
At one time, we put a flow meter at the bottom of the hill for all their buildings, and the thing came through so high that we didn't dare send them the bill.
Really?
Absolutely. We did that probably 15, 20 years ago. But we went in there, you know how you can put a weir in there and determine the amount of flow coming down? Mm-hmm. I figure there's a lot of leakage in there or something, and it comes down by that brook. And the bottom line was the bill had been like 5 or 10 times higher than normal. Mm-hmm. It was way out of whack.
That's part of your I&I.
Yeah.
I think the bottom line is everybody's going to have to make some sacrifices here. Yeah, nobody's going to be happy, obviously, throughout the town, right. whether it be nonprofits or residential or whatever. But the need's there, right. and I would like. I can't wait for these people to come in and reassess this whole thing
right.
to see what we truly need. Because I was feeling pretty uncomfortable with what had been proposed so far, and I'm not saying that's not needed, but I'm just saying. I would really appreciate this second opinion. There's no question about it. But whatever they come up with, obviously we know that some improvements need to be made, and the rates across the board aren't going to be able to stay the same. And everybody, as I say, everybody in town are obviously going to have to make some sacrifices here. And I'm not thrilled about the idea either, but, you know.
From the sewer commissioner's things, I think that we're going to discuss, you know, education strongly. But one thing that I've taken from some of these conversations I've had with some individuals and now with the school is, you know, they're very much aware of the cost because their bills have gone up. And this whole bit about, you know, using your water for your lawn and, you know, that type of stuff, I tried to explain to them how we came up with the fee. It isn't we just randomly did it. We had a dollar amount that we had to collect, and we used the water flow. So, you know, in the case like with Eaglebrook and some of the residents, I said, even if you metered that out of the factor, then that would translate that we'd have to have a higher rate for the gallons because we still have to generate that amount of dollars. And, you know, that's the bottom line. And, you know, and if we don't do that, then there's going to be a big problem, and we're trying to avoid that. Mm-hmm. And I think that everybody that I've spoke with, I don't want to say that they're happy, but I think they left the conversation understanding what's going on in town.
So, that's good.
Yeah.
Because communications is the most important part of that.
It is. Yep. They all understood it. And, you know, I do feel sorry for some of the elderly people on fixed incomes, and I did check into it, and that the sewer commissioners will, abatements for anybody for as a financial hardship with the same qualifications for real estate taxes. And I went to the assessor's office, got that, had some copies made, so anybody that does apply for that, we can give them the information and the selectman's office as well as the assessor's office too.
I heard at your last meeting that you approved, somebody applied for an abatement for water usage over and above. I thought it was automatic.
No.
Over and above the 125. I thought anybody that would, they were billed 1.25 times the winter rate.
Winters, right.
And what? If they use more, they automatically receive an abatement.
On their bill.
On their bill.
It is.
Well, like, why would somebody come and then apply for an abatement?
Well, this particular individual showed on their bill, like for the past 2 years, or the previous 2 years, they used about 50,000 gallons. Then it jumped up last spring to 70,000. And then, you know, there was a drought in the summer, so they use even more. But it's always based off of the winter use.
Right.
And my first question is, why didn't you apply for an abatement when you got your bill in the spring? Well, it wasn't that big of a deal then. And so I said, it's difficult now because now you want me to go back and abate the gallonage that you used before. And I said, I don't really... You know, and I see the numbers, and I tend to believe him, but it's the same thing. It's like, if we do that, then we don't have enough money, and then everybody's going to come in and say things. So I don't know how long the town's been doing that system of the 125%, but I'm going to say it's been some time, hasn't it?
I think they just developed that a few years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So several years back, we used to listen to abatements.
Yep.
And the abatements were typically for watering the lawns, yeah, and people with swimming pools,
right,
during the summer.
I guess my question is, how would you know the figures that they were proposing were accurate? Was it just...
What we did was we gave it to the town administrator and said, you figure it out and come back with a recommendation on every one of them.
Yep.
And he did.
Okay.
And some he gave and some he didn't.
Okay.
So what happens is you're going to make somebody responsible for it, and in this case, it was a town administrator. So they had a chance to go in there, and he was the judge and the jury.
Can I ask
sure.
a question on, I mean, I guess I'm confused. I thought that their summer bill was based on 1.25 times...
No, the bill was based upon the total usage, but they shouldn't have been billed for more than 125% of their winter bill.
Right. Okay. So why would anybody have to come in and request an abatement?
In this particular case...
I mean, there should be no abatements.
Well...
No matter what... If the rule is...
The bill should just be adjusted.
Adjusted in-house.
It's adjusted, right, in-house. But
right,
in this particular case, Bruce, what... This is where the facts. is that in 2014, they used 40,000 gallons. In 15, they used 40,000 gallons. But that in 16, they used 60,000 gallons through the winter. And what the applicant was saying is that that particular spring, he wanted to put down some herbicides to kill crabgrass or whatever. So he watered the heck out of his lawn in March, which showed up in his winter bill. And that's why it was higher. And I just, I mean...
That's up to you.
Yeah, I didn't know.
We have a rule, and we ought to stay with it, and it shouldn't even be listened to, any abatements over what we... If we're not charging any more than 1.25 times their winter bill for us, that's the end of it. I mean, we're wasting their time, we're wasting your time.
Well, it is... We don't waste Barbara's time or that officer. You know, it is... I don't want to say it's a waste of my time. I mean, I do listen to them, but I explain to them we have not given any abatements as of yet.
Right.
But I do listen to them, and I understand. And, you know, it's amazing. You know, we're humans. We're kind of creative creatures. I've heard some. You can look at a lot of things, you know, look at the same thing a lot of different ways, you know. But that's where we are right now. What going forward, I mean, we've never really established another way of doing the rates. I like Jack's, had proposed, just it was going to be whatever, I'm going to throw a number of $40 a month, and that was kind of good. But you're still going to get, there's people who have just one single lady who lives next to a family of six, and she's going to say, why should I pay the same as the people with six? So it's, I don't know.
Well, 3 or 4 months ago, I proposed and gave everybody a copy of just billing on usage only. It seemed to make sense. There was an argument about conservation. Well, so what? It's the same argument you just made.
Yep.
If you use less money, use less water, the bill is automatically going to, the rate's going to go up.
Yep.
So it doesn't, my feeling is that the most equitable way to deal with a sewer bill is to bill on usage only. No fees. You just calculate the number. If you get so many gallons, and that would, you wouldn't have no minimum fee. If you use 10 gallons, you would pay $9 a year. And all that, when you take the total gallons and divide it by how much money you need, it's simple. And if next year you use less gallons, then the rate automatically goes up because you need to account for $1 million for O&M. Then if you want to look at establishing a capital fund, you could use an EDU system or an ERU system, because that would then allow all the nonprofits and schools to be included. We've gone circles on this thing.
Yeah, we have.
And I actually made, and at the request of the last meeting, I made a phone call to David Pritchett and asked him what the status of the sewer study was. His first response was, it's complete. I said, well, it says draft. He said, well, there really isn't anything more that we can do. I don't know if we received the bill for the total $10,000 or $20,000, whatever it was.
I don't know.
We haven't paid everything yet, no.
We haven't paid everything.
Not everything yet, nope.
He said that, first of all, I responded, which we're going to talk about later. He said, well, then ask, prepare a list of questions that you want me to respond to. Or then the last email I got was, and I think everybody got it, that I'd be glad to come to the meeting. Well, it wasn't my decision not to invite him to the meeting. So I'm not sure what David Pritchett is proposing to do to complete the sewer rate study without additional fees. That needs to be answered. And if we're going to ask them to do additional work, we need a price to do that.
I thought when he was here last time, he said that if we had developed some more information, or he wanted more comparisons, he would do it for us.
Exactly what he said.
That's what I recall.
He said this whole agreement was made prior to this committee being formed.
That's right.
Yep.
And he felt that he's met the requirement of the first committee in his contract.
I didn't know they had a first committee.
Yeah, they did, three people.
The three selectmen?
No. You, Kevin, Keith, and town administrator.
And who?
The town administrator.
Doug.
Okay.
I didn't even know they had one.
Well, could I just ask, what was the purpose of that rate study? What was it supposed to tell us?
Come up with different...
Trying to figure out right now.
It was trying to tell you what the potential rates are gonna be over the next 20 years based on $35 million capital improvement plan.
And he denied advising that the rate should go up to $14 a thousand. And he said, he denied saying that, and yet it says it in the draft.
It says, right, in the report.
And then the select board, and I'm not criticizing, said, oh my God, if we go up to 14, there'll be a revolt in town.
You gotta criticize them, even if they're sitting here, you gotta criticize them.
No, but I know.
They learn to have big shoulders real quick.
No, I don't mind it at all, because, you know, it's...
So...
When you have to make decisions, it's...
So anyway, well, let me just finish my point. So we paid $10,000 for a rate study, and then we said, oh, we can't do what the rate study tells us we should do. So my question is, why did we do it to begin with when really the problem is that we're gonna have to inflict severe pain on the sewer users in this town, and we're gonna have to, and it's just simple arithmetic. If we spend $10 million, there's $400,000 a year that's gonna have to be raised to pay the debt service.
Yeah.
Well, and that comes out to X number of dollars per thousand, and how else is it gonna be paid?
And Bruce St. Peter has also said that the information in the rate study relative to the number of households is not correct.
Right, that's off.
It's off because of the assessors have better records than what we use.
Well, so. I don't, you know, what I was hoping to get from the rate study is just different ideas on how to get it, and I wasn't satisfied with that. But as far as the rate study, I mean, like you say, the bottom line is if you need $400,000, exactly. You just know in charge by the gallons. That's a pretty simple formula to come up with. You know, and
well, and I thought maybe the rate study was going to be used for education to justify the increases and to compare what our rates are to other municipalities,
which I thought they did.
Well, they did,
which they did, but we didn't really use that to justify it to the sewer users.
So that's not
in the recorder. No. It's not Dave Pritchett's fault,
right.
But the recorder had an article. It was about three paragraphs long, and it says Deerfield raises sewer rates 30% or whatever it was, and that was the end of it.
Hmm. Yeah, no rhyme or reason. Average.
And then everybody got bills that were way higher than
Well, one of the things that I've been, I don't want to say closely watching, but I've inquired a few times, is that what I've seen in the last month or so with the increase rate thing is that I think we're going to have a good amount of money put aside, you know. And there was a goal to try and raise some money, but I think it's working out even better. And it's primarily because of the private schools and the commercial aspect of it. Because the users that are well over 100,000 gallons, which is well above the average homeowner, are going to be paying quite a bit more, and so I think that's going to work out, And how can I say this? It's going to really benefit the residential rate users, And through the conversation, I was talking with the people from Eagle Brook today. I think that there's about 40 homes. Only in the old Deerfield district that aren't owned by, the schools and stuff like that. So, that will kind of lead us into our next thing of, having different management areas. I think that would also shed relief on the South Deerfield ratepayers and make the people who are really using the sewer at the other end of town and pay for it. And it's not the few residents there either, you know. And I tried, by accident, when I was talking with the folks from Eagle Brook, and I was doing the math there, you know, they basically contribute 22% of the usage, and these are very round numbers that I got from Keith, but they're only paying 11% of the cost. You know, and that, right away, I was like, geez. You know, and then
that's a good bargain.
Yeah, it is.
They're contributing 22% of the total flow.
And paying 11%.
And paying 11%, so they're paying half of what they should be paying.
And he was looking for a $10,000 abatement. You know, and that's when I did the math, and I was like, you know, geez, that's like 60-something cents a person. Mm. You know, and that.
So that's a whole deal.
In David Pritchett's study, he outlines 13 items that he was going to do. Looks like he's finished up to 8, which is take the current rate system model and use what the committee projected, the engineer projected, to be the total capital cost and develop a rate over the next 20 years. Number 9 was alternate rate system models. Evaluate alternate rate systems, fixed fee, separate fixed fee for residential, non-residential, hybrid-based, fixed rate, sending rates. He did propose some that were doomed for failure. They weren't even something that the town would impose. Then there was a draft memorandum, which I believe this is. And then there was a workshop scheduled for August 2nd. Well, actually, really, I don't know if that was when they came to us. That was he called the workshop. But it was supposed to be to obtain information from the ratepayers and hold. Then the next one was to hold a public informational meeting with all the town members to explain what they've done, how they established it, what the committee advised them to do, how they should proceed to commit, finalize the memorandum. And then the final number was 13, was to do the final memorandum. So as far as I can see, they still owe us alternate rate system models for potentially capital improvements and maybe look at for O&M. I don't think we might not be able to get that because it's already been predetermined what the study was to include. The workshop, I don't think it was a workshop. I think it was just coming and making a presentation to this committee. And specifically, there was no public informational meeting. I think that's important. That's mm-hmm. what you're bringing up. So I think we need to ask them to complete their contract. And whether they include do a public presentation on what they've established currently, or we ask them to do additional things, it's really up to the sewer commissioners.
And what study was that?
This is the sewer rate study that was contracted by the town to do.
To give you information.
Confirmation, okay.
Basically, is what it was.
And that was, you said that was $10,000. Okay.
And they made a presentation to us, I think, August 2nd.
Yep. I remember when he came.
Mm-hmm. And it was stated that, yeah, this is preliminary. We want your input. And we said, this committee is way too early to give you any input.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So when we call him 4 months later, he thinks the study is done. But he's willing to take additional comments from us, and I think at that point he might either say it's going to be X amount of dollars more to include them in the study, or that may not be feasible.
Would you be willing to just make up a short list of what you want?
I did.
You did?
Yes.
If you want to email it to me, I will get a hold of them and have that discussion.
All right.
I agree, Bruce.
Well, I think you should definitely do a public hearing.
I agree. Even if it's just on what is in here.
And I will call the recorder and demand that they send a reporter.
Yep, be televised.
To write a real article about.
What we're trying to do.
What we're trying to do and what the problems are.
I'll call and tell them Trump's in town. You know, it's based on a $32 or $35 million capital improvement project, which is okay. Even though we might not go there, but this is what an engineer said was needed. And they did the study, and this is what your rate's gonna be.
Worst case scenario.
Your rate's gonna be $40 a thousand in 10 years. Instead of not nine, $40 a thousand. And I think you'll get some people.
Well, and you know what happens when a private company like GDF Suez takes over a sewer system? They just raise the rates. And they don't care because it's.
They don't care. This is what we need to do.
This is what we need.
There's your price.
This is what we need to run this.
So you're gonna pay one way or the other.
And if you don't pay, we shut off your water.
Yeah, so you pay them to make you charge more, or you just pay more. So you take them out of the equation, then it's just money you're not having, unless you want them to go ahead and run all your plants for you. That's completely up to what the committee wants to recommend to the commissioners, my understanding.
I don't think that's a good idea. I think that, you know, the whole idea of the town running a lot of its own things, you know, it works best for the taxpayers.
I think it does personally, but.
I think it does, but it just.
That's an interest.
But this is such a difficult problem.
It is.
That, you know, as I said to Bruce before, I was reading the INI survey thing, and I made my way to the manual that tells the municipalities how to do an INI survey. It's 80 pages long. And do we have anybody really that has the time even to sit down and read that thing?
It's true.
I know, I certainly don't. I mean, because I'll be honest with you, and I'm not whining, I'm just making a statement. Every department in this building has clerical staff of mine.
Yeah.
I do everything.
But GDF Suez probably has a department.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure they probably got their own billing department, accounts receivable, accounts payable. Plus, you've got your overhead. Obviously, you've got your employees that are working there for them. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm sure that they being Suez, wants to make money off of their employee. So you're not paying just that rate. You're paying their rate plus all the overhead to make, because they're in the business to make money.
Oh, yeah.
You know? Right. So.
But I think in this particular case, the guy was really nice to us.
I think it's a great idea for him to come up.
No, I think it's a great idea, too.
He offered to come take a look and give us some ideas and stuff like that.
And I'm not advocating for that. I'm just.
No, I understand.
I'm just drawing a contrast.
It is good.
I definitely would like to get a second opinion.
But I also, this is not really changing the subject, but of all the people that I have spoken about that were upset with the rates and stuff, I've invited them, told them when their dates were and everything else. And
Well, the issue is that we didn't establish anything.
No, you didn't. And I make that, I do not pass the buck.
So there's no reason for them to come to this meeting other than complain that the rate's too high.
Well, no, I've always said that. I said the sewer study committee did not. This was nothing to do with them. It was the sewer commissioners that established this thing because we didn't come up with anything better at time when we needed to get tax bills up. So we used the same scenario. We just had to change the dollar amount.
I think that's fine.
But I did invite them all to come to the sewer study committee, and I said, if you have some better ideas, you know, you can come and voice your opinion. You know, we'll listen to you. You know,
if you want to know more about what the problems are and why the rates are what they are, what the things that we're struggling with.
As I said at the last meeting, we only make recommendations.
Sure.
That's all we do.
Yep.
I thought the informational meeting that the selectman held brought in a lot of good points. Mm-hmm. And specifically, it was, and that's why I established the use-based rate. Seem to make sense. Everybody is going to then somehow come up with a capital fund rate that all includes not just taxpayers, but all nonprofits.
And I think that if people wanted to make the investment to put a separate meter in, if that, and I don't know what the right amount is, but maybe the town could, you know, talk with the water department and pay them a certain amount of money to read both the meters.
$50 a year for a meter charge.
It's what's that?
$50 a year for a meter charge.
From the water department?
Yep.
Oh, that's how they do it. Well, I, you know, I don't know, but if that way people want to do that, and this whole thing about, you know, listening to, you know, the people, you know, they all have very unique problems and stuff like that, but it's just, it's difficult, because I did, one thing that I was concerned about is that, you know, if you really, say, you just feel sorry for this one, you know it's wrong, so you make that adjustment, then when this one comes on, then after a while, everybody's there, and then you defeat the whole purpose of why you raised the
cost. I want to back up, it's $10 a year, it's $5 a bill.
For the meter?
Yep.
You know, but then, I know I've spoken with Roger about it, and he didn't think that the water department would want to pay for the installation stuff.
Oh, but all their meters are, they don't even go to people's houses anymore.
Oh, they don't?
No, they sit in the truck and they
just get it from there.
They get it from there.
Now, when it comes
to, they can do a drive-by.
When you get to the private schools, though, I asked
Eric. The question would be, how are you going to have 2 meters detect the 2 meters?
Oh.
Because it's on a radio.
Of frequency?
Frequency.
You know, I've never spoke to anyone at Deerfield Academy about this, but the people from Needlebrook said that every well that they have is metered.
So what difference does it make?
I know, but I'm just saying that if they would isolate their own, you know, but in those cases, we don't, how can I say it? They send that information to school themselves. They read their own meters and send in a total.
Right.
You know.
They do the same with the old Deerfield Water District.
So what they should do is just isolate the part that is going to be used for irrigation.
Exactly.
You know?
I mean, if they can build an ice skating rink that's multi-million dollars, they can definitely put in enough meters to determine what their flow actually is.
Yeah. But
and I think we need to mandate that.
I also did tell them that one of the things that we were the committee spoke about is to use those flow meters. Kind of what John said, probably the technology is a little bit different today.
There's a mag meter you can use, and you can use it right outside the last outflow.
Yep.
Where the main hooks into the first manhole.
Yep. Are they expensive?
They must have a collection system. We wouldn't buy it, we just rent it.
Well, regardless of whether they have a collection system, it must meet somewhere before it crosses Route 5.
Oh, yeah.
But I know that, what's the name of that
road? Well, there's a man, you can put it,
right top of the hill.
You can put it right in the manhole.
Right.
Right.
There's one right.
Well, there's one every 300 feet.
Right on top of the hill.
With the nonprofits, I don't see this as punitive whatsoever. You know, it's, you're using it, you pay for it, you know, it's not. Everybody else in town is, so that's what's required, you know?
I mean, when he showed me his bill, I mean, you can obviously see it did jump 1 million gallons this year from all of their areas of watering. And my question is, well, why didn't you separate it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Did you ask him how much they use on the snow making?
That has its own water supply that's not metered.
A separate well?
Yeah. They have wells and ponds. And I did that. He offered that. I didn't get there.
So they use 1 million more
just for watering this past year.
Was it because they were,
that's
they
because
were putting in new lines?
$7 million building up there.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know why.
More events?
They just said because of the drought. Yeah. They just needed to water more. Anyways, we're dealing with that.
So anyway, Bruce, I don't know, a flat user rate, I'm fine with that. I don't.
I'll send it around again.
As far as individual.
Yeah. I mean, it's an option.
I like that because that was some of, you know, some of the other people that did come and complain, you know, they took it upon themselves to, you know, say, well, I'm paying $14 per thousand. I go, well, how do you figure that? Well, I only use 6,000 gallons. So if you take that minimum of $100, you know, it works out that way. And
yep.
So I said, and she's like, she said to me, I don't really care if my bill was $100 if I use that much water. She says, but I'm trying to save, so I cut back, and I'm still paying that fee. And I explained the whole thing, and whether she was totally satisfied or not, she accepted it. But, you know, that, and, you know, that was, would have answered that argument. If everybody pays from gallon one,
right,
and there's no other fees associated, then that's
what it is. Well, I think there has to be, that's for O&M only.
Yep, right, oh yeah.
Then I think for capital, everybody can't pay a flat fee. And we're gonna base, have a separate two-part billing. We use water usage for the capital also.
Just at a different rate?
Huh?
At a different rate?
At a different rate.
Yep, well, that's.
Yeah, and that way they could see what the capital is, what the, they could see.
Whatever the highway department and the wastewater treatment plant need for capital improvements that year, it's gonna be charged. Then we're gonna get back to the question on who's paying for capital improvements.
Which goes back to what you sent out.
Yeah, well, and I guess they're still researching that.
Yeah. So the next question is I'm not trying to open up a can of worms, but if that's bogus, then what other ones that are out there, are they truly a bylaw or is something that?
No, I think it needs to be resolved.
Right.
And I think when it's resolved, at that point, we need to make a recommendation.
I'll speak to this, and I hope I do it justice. If we're referring to whether or not at some town meeting there was an article that said there was a bylaw that the sewer users were the only people who are going to pay for the sewer, I believe the answer is no, that was not a bylaw, whether it's called a resolution or whatever you might want to call it. That's what it was. But according to the town council and the town clerk, but primarily first the town council said that it is the same as it's an enforceable regulation.
So a resolution is an
because
regulation,
it was vote,
not
because
a bylaw.
Right. It's what it's called is different, but because of the way it was voted on, it's an enforceable ruling.
Regulation.
Which town regulation. Lawyer said that?
Lisa Mead.
Lisa Mead.
But you can talk with
Wendy.
I'm getting bad. Thank you. You can talk to Wendy
because
about
they,
that.
They want, she was going to look up the actual minutes of that meeting and see.
Barbara did. And she actually, I could be mistaken, but I think Barbara independently called the Attorney General's office about that.
Yeah.
But
that's what Wendy said.
Yeah.
So do we have resolution?
We have a resolution of whether it was a resolution. I don't think doesn't we have resolution.
So what you're saying is it's enforceable. It's enforceable that sewer users pay for the capital.
Does it matter if we're going to put it out for a vote? Whatever has happened in the past doesn't matter. It's like, here's what we're proposing. Here's what the article is now. Let's vote on it.
I agree.
And whatever happened, whether it was a resolution or a bylaw or whatever, it's not going to matter.
I think I agree with 100%. We should have a new warrant article on the town meeting floor. Because that's the only way it's going to get resolved.
Right.
Yep. Yep.
And then we can then make a recommendation based on that. Because it might be that if it does include the entire town, we could look at how Hatfield dealt with it.
Before we do before we do that, though, do we want to check with council again to make sure that we're not opening Deerfield up for a lawsuit? Because you get somebody that looks at that and the interpretation of it and says it's enforceable, plus you look at the years of past practice that everything's been charged to sewer users, and could you be opening the town up for a lawsuit? If somebody determined that no, they didn't want to do this and hired a lawyer, Could we put ourselves in a bind as far as a lawsuit? And you do have past practice, which is considered
right
in a court of law.
The reason I don't think that you would, Jeff, is because even though that that, however you want to call it, whether it was a resolution, bylaw, it was voted. And that is the action the town has been taking. At any time, the town can get together and change bylaws. So that's what this would be, you know, if you decided to bring it forward, then it would be a new one. If it changed it, well, then it would change it from that point going forward. If it stayed the same, then it would stay the same. But, yeah, I mean, I know that the board...
Now, the next question is, do people feel comfortable bringing that forward? As it was pointed out here, you have about two-thirds of the town that are septic compared to about a third of sewer users.
You know what?
I think we as a committee should decide what needs to be done and then bring it to the select board, say, here's what we think should be done, and let them decide whether they want to make it an article in town meeting.
We think, but, yeah, I think...
And then go from there.
Couldn't this board, you know, because I know that there's opinions on both sides, couldn't this board say that we feel this is important discussion to have? Some of us agree, some of us disagree, but that's okay.
I think that should go to a town meeting.
To the sewer.
To air out all the issues.
Yeah.
And explain it, because when this was done, and I got that email that Jack sent out, and it said that town attorney Bud Pepin told the voters that more capital expenditures could appear in the future because this was only an instruction to the selectmen. Now, that's the way it was looked at back then.
Yeah.
Of course, somehow, that was the recorder reporting to John. Keep that in mind.
That's fine, but that's still what they did.
Right, but just keep that in mind. The recorder was reporting on that.
And I back up. I think...
But the bottom line is that there are still ways to pay for this thing.
Of course.
And I said that before, that when you got a $10.8 million tax tab that you're running for this town, and $2.2 million come from industry and business, there's no reason you couldn't tap $100,000 of that or $200,000 of that and commit that every year to help and let the operations and maintenance still be paid by the sewer users.
Yep.
Could we do that? John, you're talking $100,000 or $200,000. Could we simply do that out of the general fund by earmarking it with the capital sewer? Just simply capital sewer and $100,000 out of general funds or $200,000 out of general funds? Does that make it a little bit easier? You're still going to have to come up with some method, though, whether it be EDUs or ERUs. As far as the nonprofits, because it shouldn't be just coming out of the general funds, because your nonprofits would not be paying again.
I agree.
And I have nothing against nonprofits. I'm just saying nonprofits should be paying their fair share too.
Right.
Whatever we come up with, if we take $200,000 a year out of commercial taxes, and put it into the sewer, that means that everybody's that's taxed in the town of Deerfield, their tax rate is going to go up. The nonprofits are not going to be paying for any of that money that comes out of revenue and goes into a sewer fund.
But they could be charged at a different rate.
That's why you have to get ERUs or EDUs.
Either that or we, by use, have two different rates, an O&M rate and a capital rate. Do it by use only. That way, anybody that uses the system, unless then if we need a third rate for a town-wide use, then we have to do a taxation. And that doesn't work because you can't tax for something you don't use.
Right.
So I think the resolution should be that we hold the selectmen hold a public hearing and air this out relative to how if the new bylaw is needed, this is what way we understand it, and take public comment on how it should be changed, if it should be changed at all.
Here's the problems. Let them
know
the problem.
People should come. If anybody wants to say no, everybody in town should pay for it, they should come and speak. If the people that don't have sewer say, there's no way we should pay for it because we already pay for something, they should speak. And then the selectmen would decide if there's enough information warranting something to be put on the annual town meeting, they would do that.
You don't have a lot of time to do that.
Yeah, not, there isn't a lot of time.
Well, you're not gonna argue it on town meeting floor.
No.
No, that would be insane, right?
That'd be tough to do that.
Right, that'd be insane to try to do that.
Wouldn't get through one article.
We would have three night meeting. That's for the introduction.
So I'm just thinking if you have a meeting prior to.
I agree. I think.
Doesn't have to be a public hearing, but it has to be, if there's a warrant article, somehow the public has to have their input, and then they can go vote how they want to.
Of course, another thought, and obviously just a rough idea here that would need some work, but you could do a flat rate for sewer and septic users, a fixed rate for a year, per year, and everybody pays that fixed rate, and then the institutions, nonprofits are based on a ERU or EDU, whichever determined. But at the same time, not only does that money go for the capital in the operation of the sewer, but also goes towards septic replacements. So basically, everybody's paying the same dollar amount all the way through, and whether it be the public wastewater treatment plant down there, or your wastewater treatment plant in your backyard is taken care of through that fee. Because you could actually determine how much money is going to be needed to take care of that dollar amount, and then you could set that fixed rate for that.
You know why, Jeff, it's a good idea, but I don't think it would work because the cost of some septic systems are too expensive.
You made a comment last meeting, and I didn't write it in the minutes. I couldn't remember the number, but
yeah, it was pretty staggering, you know.
$5 million?
I don't remember.
Somebody doesn't abuse that, you could set parameters where septic systems only gets replaced once every 25 years as needed. If it's anything earlier than that duration of 25 years, the homeowner pays for it.
You could have $300,000 or $400,000 the first year.
Yeah, but the issue right away, what I can see, Jeff, is that right away, the first time we impose that, somebody's going to go sell their old farmhouse. They got to do a Title V. Now, if they live there for 10 more years, it might have been fine. But the minute they have to sell it and do a Title V, if it doesn't comply with new laws, it has to be changed. You know, so right away, people would be diving into that fund.
But it's only required if we impose, the town imposes that sale of the property.
You have to update.
You don't have to do it.
You just got to have your system inspected, and if it meets the current law, you don't have to do anything.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If it meets the current law, but most of them don't, old ones.
Well,
if it's a functioning system, you don't have to upgrade it because you only have a 750-gallon tank, and they want a 2,000-gallon or 1,500 now. You don't have to do it for that reason. If your system is flowing and it's going out into the leach field and it's working right, and you have a proper distribution box, and everything else is okay with it, then you don't have to replace it.
You're correct, as long as everything is within the regulations.
As long as it's functioning.
But the first time you, because functioning and meeting the requirements are two different things. So you could have a functioning system, but you might find out that, you know, after the septic tank, it goes and it might go into an old metal can. Or what I've seen a lot of times, people would take a railroad ties and it digged a hole and it crisscrossed them, leaving holes, and then they backfill that, and you can't do that. You got to tear it out.
Well,
and then once you do that, then you, depending on your soils, then it might go into an elevated system, and once you start doing that, then the tank is no good, and so that's how it all backs up. And I just think it would cause it's a nightmare on one case scenario, but I can see if five or six people did this at once, you know, it would be.
Well, there is an exemption if you sell it to a relation.
A relation, yeah.
You know, inspection. But nobody checks whether you, when you sell your property.
Well, yeah, most banks will require a Title V inspection to get a mortgage. I know Deerfield does have, whatever it is, a rule, a bylaw, whatever, but, you know, that they say you can't transfer property titles without this, but...
That's a policy that was written by Mr. Kalaszewski.
Right, and it's been done.
Well, we're dealing with one of those right now that didn't get done, so it's...
So there really is, unless the bank enforces it.
Yeah.
So it's not anything the homeowner's responsible to do, it's the bank's, if they require it, if the borrower's bank requires it, is the only time that it's found.
So...
I think we can...
Could we charge the users, including nonprofits, a fee, a capital improvement fee, and separately charge the septic owners a fee?
I don't know.
No, I don't believe you can.
I don't think
by law you can. You can't charge a fee for a service that you can't provide. And if they're not providing, if the town is not providing a sewer line, then you can't charge a sewer fee.
What about if you do it through general taxation, though?
General taxation, because you're taxing it instead of a fee. You can do that. But there again, if we're not gonna be replacing septic systems at a pool of money, then how do you charge a taxation fee that's fair and equitable to everybody, sewer users and non-sewer users?
Well, I think you could do that as far as carving out that $200,000, but then how do you charge the nonprofits?
Well, your nonprofit's gonna have to be charged an EDU or whatever towards the capital improvement.
I think if you do the EDUs, you gotta do that for everybody, including all the sewer users.
No, you could put it in the non, I'm just thinking out loud.
Well, you could, John, right.
You could put it in the non...
And that's what you should do, to raise funds for capital.
Right.
You could have the rate for the nonprofits include that extra amount. And then, so now they're paying their share.
Trying to do a two-tier rate?
Huh?
Trying to do a two-tier rate?
Yeah. And then do general taxation for the users and non-users for that $200,000.
Well, it'd be, right, $100,000, $200,000, do the general tax, right. And then do by the EDU, as John was saying, for everybody, including the nonprofits?
Just the nonprofits?
No, all of them.
For residential and nonprofit?
That way you have that fund to help build up for capital improvements.
No. You don't have to do that. You can, because they're trying to do it through taxation for the septic users. Not a fee, because you can't charge them a fee.
Right. But if you, John's saying, though, if you're doing $100,000, $200,000, whatever that figure is per year out of the general funds, then as Bruce had mentioned or whatever, and John brought up, you'd have to do an EDU rate for nonprofits and for sewer users.
Nonprofits and commercial.
Why? Why do you have to do it for them? Why just have a separate rate for nonprofits? A different tier rate?
You have a two different tier rate. One rate for EDU. So if you have a single family house, you pay one EDU rate. If you have a commercial business that needs 30 EDUs, they get billed for 30 EDUs plus the usage. All the nonprofits would pay the EDUs.
But you can't charge a septic user a fee.
You wouldn't. You'd still, your septic would still be on your own, John.
The only thing you do is you just take some money out from the commercial.
You would still have to pay for your septic.
Oh, but I'm at the point where the septic users need to
kick something.
Right, which would be part of the $100,000 or $200,000 in general tax.
But if you do a general tax, the nonprofits aren't paying. That's all you needed.
You would do a dual role, John. You would do the general tax plus the EDUs for the nonprofits.
That's what I'm saying.
So these are some of the questions we need to ask David Prickett.
Well, as this discussion's unfolding, you know, I know we talked about this at 1.2. If we went along with Bruce's idea of charging from gallon one, how about if we just had a residential and a non-residential rate? And if we, you wouldn't have to make it a lot more, but then the private schools are by far the biggest users of that. They would be paying, you know, the majority of it. And I, as we go down tonight, you know, we're going to talk about, hopefully, as, you know, having different.
What about your commercials?
Yeah,
businesses.
Well, no, the commercials and
they're going to pay whatever.
All be the same.
I think it's all the same rate.
Right. Yeah.
You know, whatever the rate is. You have a rate for your O&M.
Yep.
And that's what you're up. Then you would have a second rate based on usage.
For the EDU.
You don't need an EDU. Second rate based on usage for capital improvements. And that will fluctuate. And maybe the O&M won't fluctuate, but 15, 25 cents a year.
Yeah.
But your capital improvement sewer rate could fluctuate from $1 to $5 or back or to $10.
So septic use is not going to kick in?
Then I would think that somehow we need to talk to Hatfield. They impose a townwide tax for capital improvements. I don't know how they did that.
But they don't have the nonprofit issue, do they? Do they question?
No.
No. But
that's
but we're already covered that. We've already covered by use. A separate use fee to cover capital improvements. We're trying to get the non-sewer users to contribute. Hatfield did that, and I don't know how they did it. So if somebody knows anybody in Hatfield.
Actually, I think I do.
Okay, it'd be nice to find out how the assessors or how the Board of Selectmen or the Board of Health created that tax.
I'm familiar, but I don't think I know who he is.
I know he used to be the head of the water department there. But.
So maybe, I mean, somebody should check and see how Hatfield taxes townwide for capital improvement.
I'll check, but if I'm late next week, you'll know.
Okay, well, then you probably have to eat supper.
Oh, geez. Okay.
One thing I want to make sure of, bottom line is that the non-sewer users don't end up paying more than the sewer users.
Well, they won't.
I mean, I you know.
I don't think they will.
Well, I'd like to see the numbers.
I think everybody in town is going to pay a tax. And it's going to be a tax for sewer. Everybody in town. Then the users are going to pay a tax for the use to cover O&M. And then for another use fee rate to cover the capital improvements.
Right.
So you're going to take the taxation money and the other two pots of money from the users. And that money will equal what you need to spend every year for capital improvements and O&M.
Is there any way that you can use any of the community preservation money for that?
So moved.
No, you can't.
No.
You
can't? There's no...
Well, you may be able to say it's an antique.
Right. I was looking at that, John. How many years old is it?
Because, I mean, that would be a good way, because if you could get some of that money, because all the taxpayers pay that CPA.
CPA, you cannot... I was on the committee when it first was started, and they haven't changed. You only can use it for certain things.
Is that a state regulation or what the town adopted?
State.
Now, why we do this, like Bruce said, so the tax rate doesn't go up, is if we're contributing like $100,000 or $200,000, then maybe as a finance committee and board of selectmen, or board, you know, the select board, maybe they should... put out a notice to all the departments that they're going to have to cut their budgets because we're still only going to have X amount of dollars of revenue and let's live within our budgets.
So it's like what he's saying is that if you keep the rate the same, you'd have to cut $200,000 worth of spending out of the operating budget, which is really easy to do. We just go across your street, man.
Instead of just throwing...
They take...
That's a good point.
8/10 of what we make anyway. So...
Was a proposition 2.5.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we are limited. That's why I think we have to look at Hatfield and see how they did it. and still stayed within the 2.5. Maybe they did an override. But the $200,000 out is going to, out of the commercial might be a solution too, just for the non-taxpayers' contribution. But that will mean everybody's tax rate goes up. Because you still need that $200,000 a year to operate the town.
Or cut the budgets.
Or cut the budgets.
And you cut the budgets, depending on who you cut and how much you cut, and you're cutting services.
Exactly.
Can't plow my street.
It's okay. You tell me what you want to do and I'll do it, you know?
No, I don't, it's, I don't think it's, I don't think we can cut budgets. We can keep budgets stable, but I don't think we can cut from too drastic.
We're thin now.
Very thin. We're not doing what we need to do. We don't have the capital money set aside every year.
Well, if you guys didn't notice, I sure did, in Frontier's budget, they did not allow for their increased sewer bill.
Of course they did. None of them did. Nobody did. Even the town hall.
The
town hall didn't, the library didn't.
Oh, yeah. It's going to happen. And I've told Lynn Carey myself twice, so.
Then that's going to, I guess, going to be their problem when they have to pay the bill, right?
Because they can't come back to the town and say, oh, God, we.
Well, I don't know how that works. Can any department go to the finance committee and say, you know, we need more money for this, unless it's an emergency? I don't know.
Finance committee's
got an $80,000 fund, and
yeah, that's it.
We can't give it out except with the selectman's recommendation.
Right.
Sometimes, I know with other systems in other towns, if the request is too much, they got to go back and revisit their budget and make cuts to make it work.
Yeah.
Yep. You've got X amount of dollars to work with, and I'm not trying to pick on anybody, but,
yep,
you know, you got to live within your means. And if we've only got X amount of dollars coming in for revenue in this town, and we're facing these huge costs, you know, something's got to give.
Yeah.
See, it's just unfortunate we're just finally having to pay the piper, is what it turns out to.
Well, we, you know, I've noticed it that I know that things have changed in town, but if you grab a town, annual town meeting, or what do you call those
things? Report.
Report. Yeah. You go back 10 years and you look at last year's and you just compare the numbers, it's staggering.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I mean the town is pretty much the same.
Yeah.
But
the taxes have pretty much doubled in the last 10 years.
Yeah, and I mean I was surprised, and I say this at every meeting I'm in, is like the school, how many people that are there for the small number of kids.
It's 120 people in the elementary school. Ken
for
told us last week.
401 students, I think it is.
401 students. There's 120 staff.
Yeah.
You look at the stuff we can't control. Franklin County Regional Retirement, they want 8% more than last year.
Is it because there's more people collecting?
I don't know. I'm just looking at it. I just saw this tonight.
Yeah.
But that's something, you know, I mean, that impacts the highway department.
Yeah.
Because there's less money they have to spend.
Well, I know our big thing is our 10% on our health costs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's a huge number this year.
You know, and here's one thing. Just I know this is just kind of off the cuff, but there's quite a few people in town that work for the town that don't take that benefit, like myself and like three other people that work with me.
That don't take health insurance?
Nope.
Right.
Yeah, I get it through my wife because I can get a family plan cheaper than a single plan here.
Yeah.
But what I'm getting at is that's just another cost. Like, hypothetically, if everybody in town took it, you're looking at even more money.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and a lot of people don't really recognize the fact that, realistically, the people that are not taking it are giving a benefit back to the town, to the townspeople, by saving them money.
Yeah.
And nobody recognizes that fact. It's just like, oh, okay, yeah, thanks, whatever.
Yeah, Kevin, I worked with that for years.
You know?
Yeah, same scenario. So yeah, I understand exactly what you're saying. That our cost for some of these things
could be much
higher.
Much higher.
Yep.
So, I mean, you know, granted, you know, like you said, it's tough, you know, you've got a lot of money issues, but it could be a lot worse. It could be a lot more if everybody, if everything came into play.
Can we move to management areas? I think we want to discuss the INI.
Yeah, I'd definitely like to spend, like to talk a little bit about that if possible.
Yeah, you want to go, we'll drop down to that and let you do it unless you want to stay here all night too.
No, I'd prefer not to.
Okay.
I appreciate that.
Then we'll skip down to that and we'll.
Here's a real quick one. This is, I'm sure, well, hopefully y'all got this at some point in time because I emailed all these to you.
Yeah.
What this is something that Dave Prickett sent to me. It is, instead of answering Vuku questions, I think he tried to make it a little bit more simple.
Thank you.
Just update.
Just try to simplify it so that way it makes a little bit more sense. You know, so basically what we're looking at here is $3,856.40. Now, realistically, feasibly, that is less than $5,000, and me being the department head, I should have been able to just go ahead and do this. But I decided not to. I wanted to share this with you guys so that way you guys are well aware of everything that's going on. But I must warn you that all of this information must be put together. So what he's saying is excuse me, phase one is the planning stage for the compliance. What he's going to do is he's going to utilize all the past studies, use the existing data, take credit for the aggressive recent INI removal, example, Old Deerfield, continuous INI efforts, and this all needs to be done by 2017, by February 2017. Low cost, per se, less than $4,000. So from there, then he would go forward to DEP and say, okay, what do you think? Is this good enough? So if it's favorable, then we go ahead and we do some of the limiting monitoring, the flow monitoring, and we go ahead and we put the report together and we're done, and it's not too bad. But if DEP says it's unfavorable, obviously we're still on figure one here, if it's unfavorable, then you have to go up to the phase one analysis, which is gonna cost us more money because you have to meter per 20,000 if sewer for 12 weeks plus or minus, high ground water conditions, it definitely has to be done between March and May. So what I'm getting at is that for some reason, well, either way, I have to have these flows done next month. And I'm going to say this flat up right here, right now, that I brought this to the attention of the select board that basically states that I'm off the hook on this. If they don't do this, if this doesn't get done, if we don't get our flows done, we don't fill out the paperwork properly, we don't follow the process, that's not on me. That's going to be on the three selectmen in the town. So my plan, whether you guys agree or disagree, which is obviously your ability, what I'm requesting is either recommend or don't recommend, whichever way I would prefer a recommendation. But if you don't recommend it, I'm still bringing it to the select board next Wednesday for a vote from them, because this needs to move forward. Bruce, I appreciate, I see all that information you got there, and man, I wish I should have that same exact booklet, but I don't. Do I have the time to go ahead and put together that booklet? No, I don't. Do I have time to go ahead and take all this information and try and put it together? I do not. Again, because I don't have clerical staff, I don't have this, I don't have that. Somebody needs to do this. And I think, personally, myself, $3,845 is cheap money to be able to get us to a point of, where are we? What is it going to cost us? So that is why I am going to be pushing hard for this to be done. Now, if for some reason you guys don't recommend it and the select board decide not to do it, then that's...
I was under the impression that we had till the end of this year, but you're saying it's the end of February of 17.
Well, you have to have your flows during your high flow rate.
Right. Why does Dave Prickett think that he can petition the DEP for an opinion when their regulations just say that a complete infiltration inflow analysis of the sewer system needs to be done before?
Because of what we've already done so far. It's been a few years since we've done it.
In 99, we did it. So,
but does what we've done in the past, does that count? Or do we have to go off that 80 pages and just go ahead and do everything they do and spend arbitrary number, because I have no idea, this is just a number I'm throwing out, $50,000, when he can go and take all of his information, bring it to them, and say, this is what we've done in the past.
So we're rolling the dice that we spend $4,000, it might save us the $50,000 for the whole.
Correct. It's possible. But like I said, otherwise, if you don't, you got to spend the other money.
See, there's nothing in this proposal that he says, that he will go to DP and make a regulation, represent the town of Deerfield. It says he's going to prepare allocation, budget allocation, mitigation unit costs, prioritizing goals, and effectiveness memorandum. If he would include in this, after review of all this information, we don't need 2, 3, and 4, 3, 4, and 5. We need him to go to DEP, like this chart says. And we don't need to have recommendations on what it's going to cost, because he doesn't know. And that was my argument. When he sent this chart, I said, fine, he understood, because he and I talked about it. He understood, okay, fine, DEP's going to make the decision whether our reports, based on the 1983 manual, were prepared correctly, and what additionally do we have to do? And they're going to say, either go the favorable route or the unfavorable route. But I think summarizing what we've done to DEP is what we need to have done. Not summarizing to us or the town. Because what good is that going to do? We're going to sit here, we're going to wait for another 2 months.
Yeah.
And then we're going to be missing the date of February, March, doing any testing we have to do. So I would suggest that if $3,800 is what he needs, he's doing this from probably 20 towns in the state of Massachusetts. And he's doing it start to finish. This is, when we hire him now, he's going to be our guy until this report is final. And he's going to write it. And my question was, how much is it going to cost? He says he can't answer because he doesn't know what we've done. So I said, fine. Find out what we do, and he doesn't know what DEP is going to say. And that's fine. So we need to find out what DEP is going to say. But we have a summary of, an executive summary of every document that he's asking for. And I just think $3,800 is fine, but prepare a list of anticipated I&I mitigation unit costs. He doesn't know.
I get that.
If it's going to be $5 to do a smoke test or manhole, fine.
Right.
Well, that's a unit cost. Is it going to be $25 to do a flow metering test in a manhole? We don't need to know that yet.
Right.
And what we need to know is what DEP wants us to do. What do we have? What does DEP recommend? What are they going to accept us going forward?
Did Dave ever contact you?
I called him.
Oh, you did, and you spoke with him?
Yes. Okay. And that's where I was getting back on the study, because he told me that was one of the questions.
Yeah.
And then the other question was, I asked him about these questions, and he said he'd take a look at them. And 2 days later, or a week later, I get this from Kevin. Which is fine. This is the process that you would go through. This makes sense.
Yeah.
This is what he does for every town. But what he's asking for is not following this chart.
Right.
I mean, if he'd follow this chart and put a price to it, at least to get to the DEP stage, that makes sense. But it would be nice to know, after you get the DEP, how much is it going to cost us to do this?
Did you ask him that, Kevin, or?
Because you have to put that out to RFP, don't you?
Well, I kind of thought, like, okay, so task one, review past I&I. Task two, eliminate I&I budget estimate the budget allocations. Basically, this is my general understanding of where we're at and where we're going as far as our budgets are concerned.
Oh, we don't know.
Exactly. So then summarize what the unit cost, maybe depending on which direction you're going. Again, like you said, it's after you find out what DEP wants it to do.
Second, number two.
And then develop the table prioritizing which way we want to go.
I think all those are fine, as long as you put number two in there. DEP has to evaluate what his findings are and what direction they want us to go.
So number one would be as is,
yep.
We'll call it 1A, talk to DEP.
Have them make a determination what they want us to include in the INI study.
Yep.
If what we've done is fine, or we just need to do seven other manholes or whatever it is, he then needs to propose to you what it's going to cost to get you a final report.
Gotcha.
Yeah, and I'm concerned, I think you're fine up to a certain dollar value for procurement, but if you do it in phases, I think you're trying to sidestep the procurement regulations. Because between $10,000 and $50,000, you have to solicit three written quotes based on the scope of services.
Between what, 10 and 50?
$50,000 on the 30B.
Yeah, you only need three votes. After that, then you need sealed bids, correct?
So after $50,000, you need a RFQ with advertising. So if we're going to hire this guy, we can hire him for this, because it's best business practice. But we might not be, if he says it's under $10,000, we're still okay. But if this project is over $10,000, we've sidestepped the procurement regulations.
Or we put it out to bid at that point.
Well, then you're too late.
Well,
this whole process was...
I know, okay.
The state asked all the towns
to do this
3 years ago
to
do this. Here we go again, sitting last minute, trying to figure out a way.
How many contractors are there that do this?
Probably not many.
It's probably like three.
Probably three.
And their phones are ringing off the hook.
Probably.
Well, why don't you have that conversation with them and see what gets back to you?
Yeah, right? I think you have to proceed, and you have to have a ruling by the procurement office.
You can talk to Wendy about that.
Beyond that, I don't have any problem with whatever the price is. I just think that we need to have an evaluation that's approved by DEP, because mm-hmm. they're going to review the report. They're going to tell us how to go forward or not how to go forward by this chart.
And I think that's a good idea, because if he can get that together and make contact with DEP, boy, that sure would, you know, you'd know a lot then.
Exactly.
And I think that...
And there's nothing saying he has to go there by himself. I mean, when it comes to that point, I've got no issue going down there with him.
Yeah.
It's just...
You don't need to.
Gathering all of this information is... Obviously, you've got most of it right there.
Everybody in the committee has a copy of it.
Right.
Of all the studies that were done in 1999 to 2001, plus the Huntley study of Old Deerfield. He had the executive summaries of all of those. We could hand those to him.
Because I don't have those.
Uh-huh.
I don't think I have those. Yeah. You got your book, and this is
information. If he's going to come in here and try to rifle through these files,
right?
He's got a lot of work.
Mm. Yeah.
But I'm not going to guarantee that that's the only thing. But if these were the studies that Weston and Sampson did.
Mm-hmm.
And it was over $100,000 to do these studies.
Mm-hmm. Made plenty of recommendations.
Played recommendations, and some were followed, some weren't. And that's the problem is that the ongoing regulations is saying they want this to be an ongoing process. They want you to have a plan and implement your plan. That's why in 3 years ago, the towns either didn't have a plan or they weren't implementing the plans.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
so.
Well, I obviously I wasn't here 3 years ago, but.
It's not anybody's fault, I'm just saying.
Well, no, but I mean.
Reality of the situation.
This board has put more information together. I mean, I've been able to bring more information back to Carolyn and Trevor than I think was ever available to them before, you know, and that's, I can see. I've been in meetings where we're talking about things and, you know, we all look at each other and we don't have a clue, so we say, all right, well, we're just gonna have to look into it and we move on, you know? And then if there's nobody in the office to check into it, I mean, that's what happens. Okay. Are we done with that?
Do you wanna make a recommendation?
I'd like to make a motion that we recommend this to the Board of Selectmen.
I'll second.
Great.
I'd like to amend the motion to include review of DEP and their scope of services.
Yep.
Second that.
All those in favor?
We got first and a second. You wanna vote on it now?
Yeah.
Yes.
I was just writing it down.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
I didn't know you were the clerk.
Well.
You wanted to take notes because he's the one that has to tell the selectmen.
Exactly, so I don't wanna mess up.
Yes.
I had a first and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? No.
6-0-0.
Yep.
So it's a recommendation to.
Recommendation, selectmen, to go.
To the selectmen.
Yep, to go with this.
To recommend the engineering proposal was amended.
And what was that cost of that?
$3,856.40. Not to exceed.
Not a lump sum either.
What's that?
Not a lump sum.
Not a lump sum.
It's itemized, broken down.
For all the services, not a lump sum for some of the services.
Oh, watch that meeting, it's gonna be fun. I'm gonna say, well, this is the amount, and if you really wanna know the details, call Bruce.
We'll do a phone in.
Oh, golly, okay. Yeah, that seems to make good sense too. And if he could convince them, I mean, you know, to show them what we've been doing, that it would save us money.
Just like, for example, when we did the sump pump removal.
Right, sump pump removal.
That we authorized up to $500 per household to take it out, and we had two or three people going around inspecting.
Right.
Yep.
So he can find that in those files too. I don't think
he should be able to find that, and he should be able to talk to the building inspector.
Yeah.
And they were just in that situation, they were just removing it from the sewer and putting it outside. Correct.
Right.
Yes.
But that's a big thing to remove the INI.
Yeah.
Because some people, there are still some sump pumps that are still going into the sewer.
Was that 100,000 or 50,000?
I don't remember.
But old Deerfield was close to 400,000. That's why he indicated in his first step that he would incorporate that, because we talked about that. Removal efforts in old Deerfield.
Mm-hmm. I don't remember what they took out of
there. This is one system. Whether it was broken up into one or two systems is the issue that he might have with DEP. Because they're two separate areas that service. And
two separate licenses.
Two separate licenses.
But maybe because it's governed by the same town.
They might be in one report, or they have two reports. There's another question.
What area of DEP does this?
You got to pull the reg.
Division of Water Pollution Control.
Yep. Good job, Jack.
Well, he read the prelude to the,
yeah, I'm still
to the 80 pages, which is probably about 15 pages.
Yeah. And I like this one, this where it says, the plans will be presumed approved if the department does not issue a written approval, conditional approval, denial, or request for further information within 120 days after submittal. So in other words, if you don't hear from them, then you're good to go.
Good to go until next time.
But 120 days is a long time.
Yeah, but they, if they've got 500 communities submitting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
These reports, they might not get to us.
Oh, yeah, well, what I'm getting at is, you know, you're sitting here, you're thinking you're good, and all of a sudden, 11th hour.
Yeah, 119 days.
3.5 months later, oh, exactly. By the way.
Yeah, because, you know, you're like, oh, okay, well, we haven't heard by now, we should be good, whatever. And all of a sudden, it's like, oh, we got to do what?
It's like playing board if they don't do what they need to do.
Oh, let's not go there.
It gets approved automatically.
It's not the planning board, it's the delaying board.
Okay, we won't go there. I agree with that.
Review that, so we did it. That's it, you want to talk about?
No, maybe Kevin can just bring us up to date on the headworks, what you've been able to get, nothing much.
What we have is in there. Yeah, exactly.
We paid the bill.
Yeah.
We have paid the bill.
Yes, that one I believe we paid.
And that was $100,000+.
Yeah, it's a number that sticks in my head. I don't want to say exact number because I don't be held to the number because I'm not sure.
Having problems getting the
electronic versions, which is a good question.
And final, do we have a final cost estimate? We don't have a copy of what was submitted. Who submitted the MassWorks grant?
They submitted it for us, and we have a copy of that.
We have a Word document?
Yes. Yes, I will get that because that was given to me.
Okay, so really, it's the electronic.
That should be in my email.
The electronic set of plans is what's going to be needed by John Klein or this other person.
But they want to start paring it down?
Yeah, they're going to pare it down.
When you say electronic, you mean just email?
AutoCAD.
Oh, AutoCAD. What is those discs that came along with that? Is that not what you're looking for?
I don't think so.
I don't know. I haven't seen them.
They're just CDs that came along with the plans.
Yeah, sorry, that's what it is.
Drawing files.
It might be drawing files. Maybe the, okay. Maybe Word. Everything is here.
All right, well.
Because the only thing that was given to me?
Yep.
What I was given was that full set of plans.
Yep.
And then the Captain Lathrop thing with no discs. So when you're speaking of.
I thought there were some discs because there was another.
Discs, I'm there not was sure another what you're booklet about.
With
well,
them.
I believe you may have the one in there for the post-closure dump.
Right. Well, I'll.
Because I know all of that information just came in also. That report that just got sent out.
All right.
If we have a final product that some other engineer can take,
yeah.
Instead of recreating all the existing conditions, you can have an AutoCAD or a drawing set of plans. He can modify them. Stamp them himself and can put it out the bid.
Okay. Right.
And there's a set of specifications too, which is
correct.
A book that's probably this big, which we need in Word format.
That's correct.
So we don't have to recreate all.
He's going to take that and he's going to pare it down.
Right? Yeah, I would think if we're going to hire somebody, we need to recommend to the selectmen that we go with the headworks. I mean, I'm not sure what you're proposing for capital improvements.
I have no idea, because I have no idea what direction we're heading in, dog, because I'll be honest with you, because working as far as budget's concerned,
yeah.
I haven't even touched wastewater because I have no idea what you want to do.
It's not us.
I have no idea what they want to do. I have no idea what anybody wants to recommend.
We're supposed to give them a recommendation
a year out, almost a year from now.
Right. I'll tell you, they have no idea what they're going to. So.
Next February, I think it is.
That was, no,
it was December. December.
December?
December of this year.
Of this year.
Mm-hmm.
So it has nothing to do with your budget. We have nothing to do with
your budget. So standard budget, you do your standard budgets.
So what I'm going
to
do.
If you want a capital improvement, you have to request it. And that's between you and.
And you got to do it last December.
Between you and Kevin.
No big.
And Keith, I mean.
No worries.
If you want to do Captain Lathrop pump station, if you want to do the headworks.
Right.
But we don't know what the headworks are going to cost because we're going to pare it down.
So I can't put anything to capital improvement because I've got no information to go to capital improvement with. And then I'll be very similar to like what I end up doing real quickly for the salt shed roof.
Right.
You know, I had to put something in. Here it is. I have no idea. I had zero idea. What's the number? $38,000.
You know what's going to happen? If he puts in a capital improvement request, I think, speaking, I got two other members here, I think tomorrow the committee would turn to this committee and say, what do you think?
Yeah.
So we're back right now.
And we would turn to the department.
But the capital committee recommended the $1.2 million for the headworks like 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He didn't make a request, though, did he? I don't, was it? I forget.
Just the design cost, I thought.
I don't think we.
I think the $1.4 million was included design cost.
Yeah.
I think we tabled the total, we deferred it, and just approved the design cost. My recommendation, recollection, I don't have it with me.
I would have to go back and look, but.
Oh, did it get voted?
I do remember what Jack was saying, though. That did sound a little.
Didn't get voted, right?
I thought you guys voted it and recommended it, but it never went forward, because the selectmen's got to put a budget article on there to.
We didn't vote that.
I don't think it was voted only for one reason.
I mean, I really don't know what to do.
And that was because they added stuff to it.
Right, it went from $1.2 million to three something.
So realistically, what my plan was.
I think maybe you should look at making some minor capital improvements to Deerfield safety issues.
Right.
And make some safety improvements to Old Deerfield. I mean, South Deerfield.
You should do something, even if you start with a hood system for South Deerfield.
Actually, that's being, I've already, I bypassed everybody. I'm doing that. It's being installed tomorrow.
Yeah.
I have not, something like that, I'm not even going to bother going in front of anybody. It's less than $5,000. I'm the department head. It's a safety issue. It's being done, period.
If it's less than $10,000.
No, I have a $5,000 that I can spend without going to anybody.
Right.
I am restricted to $5,000 by the select board.
Technically, $4,000.
Although unless it's related to real estate, you don't need to go to CIPC if it's less than $10,000.
Right. Now, let me ask you this. So when it comes to less than $10,000, but whatever I buy has got a life expectancy of 14 years.
Doesn't matter.
Okay, so.
We don't want the waste basket. It's got a life expectancy of 20 years.
Yeah, well, hopefully that won't last, it won't cost that much, but.
As an extreme example.
Right.
But I think at Old Deerfield, what we saw, they had to creep out over on that.
Oh, yeah, oh, there's lots of guardrails and handrails and things in there that need to be upgraded at the very least. It's just basic safety at this point.
So you put it in your budget. You don't have to.
Put it in your operating budget, operating stuff.
That's what I would say.
Exactly, because it's being small enough, it won't have to go to capital.
I mean, just break it out as safety improvements.
Safety improvements, yeah.
So, but as far as.
Stairs up to the sludge tank.
Yeah.
Which now are pieces of wood laying on the ground.
Yeah, exactly. Or better yet, when the guy goes around the corner to try and reach down to grab his thing in the morning, there's one area, there's nothing keeping him from falling.
Yeah.
You know, not in the tank, but off to the side. You know, we had an issue with part of the railing failing a week ago. I'm sorry, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, I think these are the things.
So it's because the concrete's failing and.
Until we can make a recommendation, you have to.
You got to keep up with the safety stuff.
Yes.
Make sure somebody doesn't get hurt or killed.
Yeah.
So.
And maybe when we have one operator at Old Deerfield, maybe there's a radio that needs to be.
It's not a bad idea. Or give them a little life thing like we gave my mother. Seriously, it works great.
Something, and we've got one operator, especially in Old Deerfield, I think it's.
I mean, because you could be down for hours and nobody knows the difference.
Just falling down that 30-foot drop to.
Yeah, into the sump.
Sump. Nobody would ever know.
No.
Not until the next shift came on.
The next day, and the same guy wouldn't show up.
Yeah, I was just going to say it's the same guy.
No, but they rotate. So they go once a month.
No. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
Next month they'll find him.
No, actually, for the most part, Dennison, which is the newer hire, he is basically staying in Old Deerfield. He has been trained in South Deerfield, so he knows everything needs to go there or has to happen there. Because they do rotate their weekends and holidays. But for the most part, the two of them are over here in South Deerfield and Dennison is over there. Granted, Keith goes over and oversees what's going on whole nine yards. But like you said, I, you know, he could, if he fell at 8 o'clock in the morning, if it didn't happen to be a day that Keith was going over to look or something like that, you know.
The readings wouldn't be made.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Then somebody at that point would know.
Is it most?
No, 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 because all the readings.
Is it just railing?
It shouldn't be a discussion.
I know, I'm.
You know what I'm saying? It's just.
It isn't, it's poor waste of time.
Yeah.
You had talked about a pickup truck replacement.
At some point in time, they were looking for something different, you know, we can hold off on that. You know, they can just keep ratting in that, the one that they're in right now. Is there issues with it? Yeah, there is. Is it going to cost us money? It's gonna nickel and dime us, but.
Where do they go? Just from one station to the other?
Pretty much there in the transfer station.
Why can't you use a highway department pickup?
That was a highway department truck.
No, but use an existing one.
No.
Who maintains it?
I do.
You do.
Yeah.
Actually, you did a pretty good job of rehabilitating it.
Yeah, it looked good, that's right.
I mean, you know, we threw some paint onto it, we went ahead and we took a bed off of another truck. I mean, you know, we did the best we can with what we had, but we were.
What year is it? Do you know why? I'm just saying that if there are things like that, get those out of the way.
I don't think that's part of this committee.
Yeah.
I think we're wasting our time.
Okay.
Talking stuff. That's my opinion as a committee member.
I've listened.
I think what happens is, I think he wants to hear some positive reinforcement from the committee, and he's hearing that.
He hasn't submitted.
We're all agreeing that something should be done.
He hasn't submitted a budget to us on our other committee.
Right.
And we're looking for that, and the reason is because he's waiting on us.
Yeah.
That's what I've heard.
Well, as far as,
We're not giving any approvals to him to do anything.
Well, no, I'm just looking for recommendations.
I'm recommending that he do something, get things rolling.
Our mission is to go to the select board next December and say, here's what we think needs to be done.
I just wanted to make that clear.
This December.
And I appreciate.
So he can cross the hood off the list.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
No, I thought he was done.
No, the hood's there.
Hood's being done, actually technically it's being done tomorrow.
No, I agree 100% with you, but I think if there are safety things, you should include them.
Oh, I agree.
Yep.
Right?
All right, I think the last thing that we need to talk about a little bit is establishing a management areas between the two plants. Any thoughts on that?
Well, you had said that you had a guy that you were gonna talk to, but he was like in the hospital, or he was?
I'm sorry, I don't recall that.
It was on Lee Road at the corner of near Stillwater.
Tom Scanlon?
Tom Scanlon. He wasn't, you was Bob Decker was going to talk about.
Oh, sorry, Bob Decker.
I didn't remember.
That was kind of like the districts.
Well, I for districts, and I.
Then we went to management areas.
Yeah, I just wanted to keep.
What's the difference?
I guess we don't want to establish the two districts. We want all to be under one house. We just want to call it and separate the operation cost and the collection. So that's why we're going with management area. I still call it districts, but I don't want to split it up. I still want to have, you know, leave the control with the select board and just be able to, you know, allocate whatever money's collected in South Deerfield for the South Deerfield plant and for the old Deerfield plant and keep them separate. I don't have real accurate numbers, but when I was looking at what we collect and, you know, the rough figures I got from Keith, you know, it's still glaring to me that South Deerfield is subsidizing the old Deerfield plant, you know. And I think that if we can create these management areas, the rates that the users, you know, whatever we put, if we go with, you know, we start charging from the first gallon, and I'll just throw it out there, South Deerfield's rate might be $10 a gallon, or $10 a thousand, but in Old Deerfield it might be $15 a gallon because there's, per thousand gallons, because, you know, of the way it's set up. And I think that it would bring much relief to the residents of South Deerfield, because the residents in Old Deerfield are nearly non-existent, like I keep saying, there's under 40 homes.
30.
Yeah, so, you know.
So I'm definitely in favor of that.
Don't we need to conclude whether we're going to keep old Deerfield going before we go down the road to?
Well, I mean, we move it down the road first, then if old Deerfield is the decision we made to keep it or move it, then that management area would pay for those improvements.
And the reason that I'm feeling strong about the management area is because that's something that, you know, if we think that it's a good idea and we make this recommendation to the select board and the select board acts on this, then, you know, going, you know, next year, you know, come whatever it is, September, when you set these rates, we'll be all set up to separate, make this separate, you know?
Yeah, I guess on a short-term.
In a short-term basis.
Long-term, I think, I don't know, we discussed a few weeks, meetings ago, about having the nonprofits decide what they want to do with the plant, because they're the ones that really are using it.
Well, I had a conversation.
Whether they want to put the money into improvements or put the money into having it treated at South Deerfield.
Or just pay the fees.
I guess I'm a little hesitant to speak like this, but I've only had the conversation today with Eagle Brook, and they felt that the $30,000 bill was a lot. I don't know how they would take their portion of a $200,000 annual bill, and that's kind of what they're going to be looking at. You know, I didn't take it to heart, but off the cuff is, well, maybe we should look into developing our own, you know, sewer treatment plant, and I said, good luck.
Yeah, knock yourself out.
Yeah, so.
Think this is cheap?
Yeah.
Or this is expensive?
It's the kind of thing, so, you know, I did speak with Bruce St. Peters, and perhaps maybe other members of this board thought, you know, we should get the, you know, private school people in here to listen to this. I just, and I guess I don't have a problem with that, but I don't want it to derail the fact that, you know, this cost is going to be bared by them, by, you know, because they're the biggest users of it.
Oh, for sure.
So.
Do you have any other percentages for, you said, for example, you said Eagle Brook uses 22%. How much does DA use, and how much does the other school use?
I think Vermette was ballpark roughly 2%. Historic Deerfield is about, huh?
They were higher.
They were higher, but I still think that they're around 5%, maybe 4%. And, you know, the 40 homes, they're in the vicinity of the 3% or 5%, so the rest of it's Deerfield Academy.
So Deerfield Academy's somewhere around 50-something percent, then?
More like 70.
70?
You know, and I could be off.
It's up there.
60 to 70%.
Yeah. So.
Well, if you got 70 and 22%, that's 92, and then you turn around and add Historic Deerfield on, and then add Vermette on.
3, 4, 5, 7.
Then add the houses on.
Yep.
I think DA should be down there around 60, 65%.
Going off the percentages.
Yeah.
Is what I was just writing down, yeah.
Yeah.
So the management, what, if, that sounds like a great idea. Has anybody ever done this before?
What's that?
Management areas on a septic? We have to go to legal counsel?
We've already checked into that, and we definitely can do that. It's not an establishment of a district. You know, what we're doing is basically saying that we operate these septic system, I mean, these sewer systems, and there's a definite area that is served by the one in South Deerfield, and a definite area that's served by the old Deerfield one. And if we choose to split it up and make the users of those facilities pay for it, then that's perfectly fine.
Because we have two separate sets of data, which one's old Deerfield Water District and one's South Deerfield Water District. Those are the two management areas of those that are sewed within there.
Right.
So what would need to be done, if you make that recommendation to establish them, we'll have to then determine how the costs are allocated.
the cost would be allocated by the, whatever it costs to run that operation.
I understand.
Now, the...
There's some that have to be allocated, though, that...
Because, well...
Fixed among the two of them, like Keith.
Keith, exactly.
As an example.
Right, right. And that would, I mean, I think that would be a fairly easy thing to do.
Oh, yeah.
You know, just whatever his salary is and stuff like that.
I don't need it, based on usage, that's...
Yeah, time spent there, you know? And if it's off, you know, 4 hours a week, I don't think that that's a big deal, you know? And I, you know, the conversations I've had with Keith, it would take a little bit of effort, but, you know, I don't know whether they're oxygen bottles or whatever chemicals they use and stuff like that. You know, and if he does, I don't know, does he do all of his testing in South Deerfield, even for Old Deerfield?
They do some preliminary testing in Old Deerfield. They do have a small lab there, which isn't very much. It is a smaller lab. They do a lot of their BODs right there because it's simple things that they're able to pour, stir, set in the thing, it automatically stirs it up, it shuts it down, and he reads it on a certain amount of times. He's got like, well, like when you used to redo develop film, you know, that old style.
Sure.
He's got one of those where he pushes it, goes so far, it dings, as soon as it dings, and he goes and he looks, and it automatically keeps going, so he writes down what that is. So everything he has there feasibly can be going in the computer, but they're still handwriting everything.
So I think that, you know, it would be relatively easy to establish that, say, you know, like 80% of his salary is paid by South Deerfield, 20% is paid by Old Deerfield, and the employees who stay down there, their entire salary would be paid by Old Deerfield, and the other employees that stay up here would be...
Electrical costs, all those things.
You only need to allocate the ones where they're serving both plants.
But they're all, you know, there's nothing, I mean,
those
we might
costs,
get...
Those costs, not just people.
What's that?
Any costs that serve both plants, not just people.
I don't think there really is any, because electricity is all separate.
Well, just the INI study, there'd be a cost associated with that. There'd be a cost.
Right, but you could still split that up.
No.
Certainly can't split it up.
What's that?
They'll just have to be identified and then split up.
I think the only thing, going along with that, I think the only thing that'd be a little difficult is going to be salary-wise. Because when you have, because then you're going to have to start figuring, okay, so Keith does so many weekends a year, and his pay rate is this compared to Dennison, who is this.
You know what to do? Keep it simple.
Just take
all those costs, add them up, comes to $200,000, and allocate it based on the gallons coming out, going into each plant.
You're
done.
Yeah.
But you understand where I was coming from?
Yep.
I understood exactly where he was coming from.
Yep.
But I just didn't want to have something all right. Well, this is how we're going to do it, and say, all right, well, I hate to be the person that keeps throwing the fly in the ointment.
No, that's right.
There's simple ways. I think
keep it simple.
Keep it simple.
I agree.
And this is a moving target, so, you know, these things will come up and we can address them. And, you know, if we all of a sudden we say, you know, we didn't think about this, guys, and they'll say, okay, well, we'll change it, you know.
I mean, I think it should be, once the selectmen decide to move to that, maybe they should hold meetings with...
The other ones. Well, I mean, let's...
Stakeholders.
What do you guys think about it? I mean, you know...
I think it's an excellent idea.
I think it should be done.
I think it's a good idea.
John?
I think it can, as long as you can do it without a lot of extra work, I think it's a good idea.
I think we should try to establish something for FY18.
Yep.
And set up some parameters and then implement it in 19.
Yeah.
That way we stay with the budget season and...
Okay. All right.
Not a budget item, though.
No, but it's a warrant article.
It's fee-based.
Yeah, but isn't it an article?
It's a warrant article.
Yeah, it is a warrant article. Mm-hmm. It's true.
So, I mean, there's a lot of little things that have to be worked out, but it has to run its...
The general idea.
It's going to take
six
months to figure it out.
Didn't you fax me a law, I forget what it was, that basically gave the select board the authority to do that?
That was the one that's in question. I think Bruce sent it to you. Bruce St. Peter's.
No, I'm not talking about Tom. I'm talking about the state law.
Is that you, Jack? The thing on the districts?
That was on establishment of management districts. It was like a...
I'll have to look.
Like a manual of establishment of...
Yeah, there was some... Somehow I
is
got...
Is that the one that... You actually spoke about it.
Right. I brought it forward. And
I don't remember even... Okay. I don't remember even... I looked at it.
Yep.
And I I don't think I sent it to you, I don't know where it came from, but...
I don't either, but maybe...
It's very, looks like it's open to interpretation.
And if the Board of Selectmen voted to adopt it, it gave us authority to deal with rates, areas, and all that stuff.
Yeah, if it was a state law, if you adopted this state law, you could do this.
Right, and I can, anyways, I'll talk with...
So you may want to have that, so you can vote that at this town meeting, if you're going to look to...
Right.
Well, I guess, I'm not saying that I wouldn't bring it to a town meeting. What I'm saying is I think that the Select Board can do that regardless of the town meeting.
I think without, there's a state law that allows the Select...
Not if you got to vote it to accept that law.
No, the Select Board vote to accept that law, that was clear.
So it's not a town meeting, then?
It might not be, but I'm sure that... I'll talk with Wendy and have her check with Lisa as well. But, what the heck was I writing? Second meeting, so we end. I know. Oh, I'm sure that there'll be something that I...
I mean, it might take a subcommittee to work on it. It might take three or four people to...
Let me...
After you guys figure out what you want to do. Maybe two or three people can just meet, you know, just get things out.
I'll stop in and see Wendy tomorrow, and I'll ask her to check into that, and I'll bring it down so she knows what I'm talking about. But I don't really remember, there was too many inquiries ago, but I'm sure that when that came in, and I'm sure that we discussed it, and I'm also sure that we voted to adopt it.
Okay. Is it all right if I put the committee supports the idea of management plans and minutes?
Yeah.
Is anybody fine with that?
Fine with that.
Fine with it, yep.
I think that's about it. Does anybody else have anything else they want to talk about?
Yeah. I don't know, how many meetings have we had here?
A lot.
14.
I feel we're getting nowhere.
13.
I really do. I'm sorry, I don't know whether maybe you guys disagree. But we sit here, we spent 3 hours, and what do we accomplish? Well, we got the management district thing.
Well, I think...
I just feel like we're just kind of stumbling along.
It's a difficult job to get this done.
But I think we should prioritize...
One thing to get done.
Something, what's most important, and then let's work on it and do it and conclude it, and then go to the next thing. Maybe our agendas every week are too big.
Well,
I hear what you're saying, John, but, you know, when you take a look at what we're covering here, they're all kind of interlaced together. So to make progress on one thing, you've got to make progress on another. And it almost forces you to take on more than one item at a time with what we're dealing with, such as... having these two people in to give us a second opinion. That's going to make a huge difference, I think. It's going to help us move forward to where we are now and what actually needs to be done and some new ideas on how we can move this forward. As far as where we're at now with funding ideas and management areas, you know, it's taken a long time to get to this point, but I think we're finally getting to this point. We're narrowing that field. Before, we were all over the place. And, I mean, we had some discussion tonight that I think, you know, 3-4 meetings ago, we would not have been able to have those discussions.
Right.
And, I mean, you know, even with the bylaw, we're moving forward with that.
And the only light that I can shed on that is that I tend to get frustrated with stuff like this because it's like, you know, you're not getting something done, and I like to see things done. But where it's really opened my eyes is that I've left here a lot of nights thinking, you know, like, hey, you know, that's a really good idea. Bruce had a really good idea, and that had a really good idea. But where it all came together for me is when these people were complaining about their sewer rates, and they come in, well, did you ever think about that? And I go, yeah, we did. We talked about this, and this is why we didn't go out like that. Well, what about this? And I go, yeah, we did talk about that as well. And it really opened my eyes to the dialogue that we've had.
A lot of,
you know,
general background knowledge that you need.
Yeah, and we've eliminated a lot of you know, bad stuff. And I've always spoke very highly of everybody on this board of, you know, the amount of work and knowledge that's gone into this thing and, you know, the good debates that we've had and have separated, you know, the really good ideas from the maybe not so good ideas. And even though we haven't gotten to that point, like Jeff said, I really think we're getting down to an area where we can start making some good recommendations and stuff. But it has been a long time, and it is quite frustrating.
It's just,
I know, I hear you.
John, I hear what
you're
saying.
That's okay. You disagree with me, that's fine.
Well, right. No, John, I hear what you're saying, and I respect that.
I don't fully disagree with you, but I also think we're kind of inching our way towards, mm-hmm. And I was even thinking today of making a list of the things that we've come to a consensus.
Well, I'm glad you got, I was just going to say that. Go through the 13-minute meeting minutes that we've had and do a word search for rates. And then do a summary of what we discussed. Because at some point we're going to have to do that because we have to prepare a report. So if we go through and say, this is what we discussed, this is what we threw out, this is what is still good, oh, this is all our discussion on rates, this is all our discussion on infrastructure improvements. Mm-hmm. These are all, you know, if we do a summary of what we've done so far, maybe that would be helpful. But I, to be honest with you, I can't do anything between now and mid-March.
Is the I&I part of what we're supposed to be doing?
Yes.
So what are we going to do? Not do anything until and then make a recommendation to the selectmen next December on the I&I? That has to be decided
forward,
before
so
then.
We took care of it.
I think we made a recommendation to start the process, and the process, after this process is started, we'll have a better idea, or Kevin will have a better idea, how he proceeds through the government approvals.
So we start with basically task one, which is take everything, put it together, and go to DEP, correct?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So it'll be 101A.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
And
where are we at there? Now,
what do we have to do?
Do we go up where the big dollar signs are on that little chart, or do we stay down low?
I understand that. I get the
single
chart.
Right, no, but what I'm getting at is, I think it's, excuse me, as far as that one's concerned, like you said, it's, one is take everything together, two, go to DEP, and then report to you guys.
No,
but
I don't think you need to report to us. I think you need to report to the selectmen.
And but what I took from this is that now when I meet with the other two selectmen, I can say that, you know, we discussed the design, and this is why, you know, this board came to a recommendation that we do this because, you know, of, you know, the things that are laid out in this space. So, you know, even though I'm here and Trevor and Carolyn aren't, I can relay that to them, and, you know, so they understand and feel comfortable. I mean, because there's a lot of things that come before the select board that, you know, I don't get, and a lot of times none of us really get. And what happens is it just gets
put
up.
You don't understand mosquito districts?
Oh, that's the problem I do. And I
mean, if I had my way, I would say this is how we're going to do the sewer rates, and this is how we're going to do the infrastructure.
Yeah.
I would prioritize it, and then start working on it. At this point, that's the way I feel.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Subcommittee of one.
Subcommittee.
No, I understand what you're saying. We talked about this. When I start writing these minutes, I say, well, I think I've already written this a couple of times.
Right, repeat, right.
And I do agree with you. But what I do like is that every time that we have these, I feel better about, you know, the decisions and the conversations because we've eliminated.
We're making progress. It's slow, but we're making progress. Yeah. And we're all self-educating, too, learning all about this and what's good for the town.
Yeah, I mean, just like you guys, that, you know, when I first went to the treatment plant. This was the first time I had ever been there, and it was an eye-opening.
I had never been to it.
Yeah.
I knew zero about.
Oh, right? Yeah.
It was just.
And just like that trip to West Agawam, it was another enlightening thing. We were really there for
an
hour.
That was time well spent. Besides the ice storm that we drove through.
Yeah.
But. And by the way, you did a fine job.
No crash.
Fixed the wiper blade on my side of it.
Right. What's that?
You did fix that wiper blade on my side of it. I'm like, never mind.
Are you kidding? Do you ever look through these things?
Maybe it's a good thing
wiper
you couldn't
see.
Yeah, all good point.
How about if we set the meeting
date
so that we can move along?
Yep.
It's only been 3 hours tonight, and we're getting shorter and better.
Days are getting longer.
The you want to meet March 16th?
You want to go back to Thursday?
Today is Wednesday.
Reason we didn't a Wednesday this time was
because of the scams.
Meeting tomorrow.
Tomorrow, right.
All right. Well,
March 16th is a Thursday.
Is it second or third?
Third.
It's the third.
Is that their meeting night?
I already marked it down from last time.
There's five Thursdays in March.
Not that this means anything. I'm just letting you know flat up that the 16th I'm flying out to Arizona, so.
Lucky guy.
Yeah.
That's lucky. Yeah. Well,
the 9th?
Skims? How long?
Skims usually the third Thursday?
Yeah, usually the third Thursday.
You want to do it the 23rd? Or 9th or 23rd?
How about the 15th? You'll be here?
Kevin will be here the 9th.
The selectmen are meeting.
I can't do it the 9th.
Oh, can't do it the 9th.
I will.
How about 23rd?
Grant, do it the 10th.
He would have only been back one day, if that matters.
That's okay, he's good.
23rd?
23rd.
That works for you? 23rd?
I may be a little late because I got training in Springfield and I've been there until 5 o'clock.
Is that a Thursday?
Thursday.
Thursday, 23rd.
But don't you want to have it on a Wednesday?
He can't come on Wednesday.
No, the selectmen meet every Wednesday in March.
Oh, they do.
Keith can't come on Wednesdays.
So let's do it Thursday, the 23rd?
Wednesday, 23rd.
So it's going to take you 45 minutes, that hour of the day to get home.
I don't know where they're going with 6:30.
How do we want to change the agenda? We just follow up on management plans?
6 o'clock?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's okay with me.
Any further discussion on Captain Lathrop? Do you think you'll have anything from him?
I certainly hope we got something from him.
I'll leave the general ones on, the rate study, because I'll have questions to David Perkin, hopefully they have answers.
Never ending.
So we don't need that one?
I know.
We don't need designer anymore? And the question is, are we going to, well, we'll know at that meeting, we'll be discussing the headworks with a guest.
Yes, maybe two guests, maybe three guests.
You can get me the guest list. So I can have any.
RSVPs?
I have both their names if you'd like.
No, I got one of them. I got them both written down.
Okay. All right, that's it, I guess. So, anybody make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.